for us who were, it was very scary, because when you're at the lows of your lowest, it's easy for you to fall for that. Mm. Everybody wants money. Everybody, yeah. I know people that sold their soul for money. Yeah. I was in that position that I could have sold my soul for money. I'll be fucking wealthy now. I'll be running around, but my soul will be gone.
Yeah.
So I had those opportunities twice.
And you never went to the hockey club?
What hockey club?
Okay, he's never been there.
With you, I need to be very careful. What am I saying?
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a special edition of Podcast and Chill. We're coming at you live at Daruma in Waterfall, Midrand, South Buga.
First time here.
Yeah, Oskido owns this joint.
Oh, dope. Beautiful joint.
And man, from one legend to another, please welcome a true legend of the game.
Yes.
His name is Teko Modise, a.k.a. The General.
What's happening, dog?
Yeah. I'm good, and you, boss?
Eh, Ukraine.
Ukraine, Jam.
So you were saying, because I've been trying to get him for how many years now, eh?
I think over a year.
Over a year, then?
Over a year.
And then he saw Robert on the podcast, he's like, fuck it, I'm coming. I remember the last time I saw you, dog, we were at, it's now Konka, but it used to be Icon Soweto.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it was like 3 in the morning.
Yeah, yeah,
we were both late.
In the morning.
Yeah. We were both late, and we started having like DMC chats. Because I was telling Teko, I'm like, yo, bro, like, yo, I'm down and out. Hey, I don't have a job. No one wants to book me. The friends that I used to have don't even take my calls anymore.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I know you went through the same thing.
Lost flavor.
Yeah. I've lost flavor. And I was like, how did you handle it? I remember you gave me some advice. Remember that day?
But it was 3 a.m., my bro.
Yeah.
So I probably don't remember what I said. But I could relate to the story that you had. Because in the industry, I don't think there's guarantees in this type of industry. You know that when you're up there, you've got a lot of friends. Everybody wants to hook up with you. Everybody wants to do certain things with you. But when things are not well, you know, all those friends starting to drift away a little bit.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
So you end up finding yourself all alone. I think I understood exactly what you were going through.
Yeah.
But it was 3 a.m., dude. I mean, come on. I don't understand why we had such a deep conversation at 3 a.m.
I was in my emotions. Like, when I get drunk, I get emotional.
Yeah. Me too. When I get drunk, I become so emotional.
Yeah.
So I understand.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. Please, can you ask them to keep them down? Keep it down a little bit. Sorry, Malum. Can you just keep it down a little bit? We're doing an interview. Yeah, that's fine. Sorry about that, ne?
Sorry, guys.
Sorry about that.
Apologies.
Eh? Yes, I know.
Yeah.
Ask his name, Malum. Ask his name. And then, yeah, let's talk about life after football. How's that been like, bro?
I think it's been very challenging because now you don't have those contracts, those signing on fees.
Yeah.
Now you have to actually work.
Yeah.
Put in the work and wake up in different hours and do different things that are out of your comfort zone. So I think it's been a little bit challenging, but exciting as well.
Yeah.
Because I knew it one day that football will end.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? And I needed to prepare myself, psyche, as to what is it that exactly that I wanted to do. But the flop book order now, when that time came, I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do. Everybody's pushing me to become a coach. Coach. I think because that's what everybody footballers, maybe most footballers actually do.
Yeah.
So I was like,
hey, fuck it, let me start a podcast.
Now the podcast opportunity came later on, but I still wanted to be in the space of football, but I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do.
Mm.
And then the opportunity of me becoming a sports analyst, and it came through. Mm. And actually came through while I was still playing, because I remember doing the World Cup for SABC.
Yeah.
And I was still playing at the time as well. And after that, and then there was Super Sport. I was like, no, he needs to come this side.
Mm.
But I was still playing then. I said, and then I'll think about it once I retired. I retired on Friday, and on Monday I signed the contract.
Isn't it tricky when you become an analyst? Because most of the guys that you're talking about, you either played with them or like you saw them in the academy or something.
Yeah.
Because like right now, everybody in England, right, is asking for Ole to be sacked.
Yeah.
Except Rio Ferdinand, Gary Neville, all the guys that played with him.
Yeah.
They're like, I know, give him some time.
Yeah.
Is it the same with you?
The challenge with me is, of course, these are the guys that you know that you're still going to meet. And whether you're becoming honest or you want to lie, you know, just to... You need to spare their feelings as well, because at the end of the day, these footballers, they actually go out and actually listen to what you guys are saying. So it's not like what we're saying, they don't know, it doesn't get to them. Yeah, they actually do get to them, even the coaches themselves. Because I remember one stage when we analyzed a certain team, and then we a couple of months later, we had the stadium. Then the coach was like, why are you giving away our tricks? Like, I didn't know that you coach were listening. So I realized then that, hey, I can't be biased when I'm getting that opportunity. I can't lie. I need to be honest also with the guy, but I can't bash the guys, because I need to understand also that the game is a game of mistakes, and people need to learn from those mistakes. But I'm not saying I'm perfect, but I'm not going to put myself in a situation that if it was me, so I'm not going to speak from my side of view. So I'm going to speak of football, and then I need to be honest to them, because I know and I understand as well that I was once a footballer as well.
Yeah. And so growing up, do you think your dad was your analyst? Because he was a footballer as well, right?
Yeah. Look, my dad never told me that he was a footballer. I was told by neighbors that he was a footballer. But he's the guy that actually took me to my first game at FNB. But he never wanted me to play the game.
Yeah, I remember he kicked you out.
Yeah, he kicked me out. I think he was mad at the game. I think something happened, you know. And then he never wanted me to play the game. So he was always pushing me to go to school.
It wasn't Junior Kanye, ne?
Don't start.
Come on, dude.
Don't start. So he pushed me to go to school, not to play the game itself. So whenever there were guys coming in to try and lure me to come and play for them, he never liked it. After they left, I'll get a beating because he didn't understand why I was still playing the game. So you know when somebody, like as a kid, when somebody says don't do that, you actually go out and do it.
Yes.
So I was told not to play the game. So I wanted to find out what is it about this game that he doesn't want me to play. So we never actually had a relationship after that, because once he kicked me out at 8, and then I became a street kid for a couple of months. Because I didn't know. So I know the first time I ate chicken licking was in the dustbin, dude.
Dustbin.
I'm bullshitting you. Yeah. I cannot see when you throw those bones today. That was the first time,
bro.
Yeah, because the thing is, like, at the time when I was young, I stayed with my dad for a long time.
For
like
sure.
7-8 years. So I never knew any side of my mom's side. Because he was that guy that will actually cage me into not knowing anything about anybody else. So when he kicked me out, I didn't know who to go to. Mm-hmm. And the funny part was my next door neighbor, where I was staying with my dad, it was my my family from my mom's side.
They couldn't know.
No, I knew,
but
they couldn't take me in for some reason. And then I had to stay and be a street kid. I don't know where my mom got the message from. And I didn't also know where she was at the time. And then she came back and searched for me until she found me.
So that thing of like...
Do you know why your dad did that? Like shield you away from your mother's side of the family?
Look, I had an opportunity, I think last year or year before, seeing my dad for the first time after that incident
when I was eight. When you're eight, yeah.
Yeah, and then I tried to ask him. He was still, you know, not telling me the truth about it. Man. But I think something happened to him. I don't know, because my dad was dodgy, dude. He'll come back late at night bleeding. And I'm like, what's wrong with this guy?
For real? This guy,
and nobody would ask him, because he was that type of a dude. He was very secretive. He was very quiet. And everybody around us was scared of him, and I was scared of him as well. So I didn't ask him.
Shy.
Fucked up. No, my dad will beat me to
belt. Power. What was he using? Belt?
No, you know like there was those kettles that had the cable from end to end.
Yay!
That cable.
Electric cord.
Electric cord. That's what you use. And I'm fine, to be honest with you, I never saw myself as a very naughty kid. I was doing what other kids were doing. Maybe the worst thing that I did as a kid at that time was to break somebody else's window with a tennis ball.
For that's sure. Normal. Yeah. That's normal.
Yeah, that's the worst thing that I've done. But other than that, I remember one day he actually told me to go buy groceries at the store when he came back from work. Because he was always at home around 6-7, right? And I think he was a petrol attendant somewhere called Ranbeck. So when he came back, he was like, go buy this and this and this at the store. I went there, and as I came back, because I was very young, I got robbed, right? So I was scared to go back home.
Of course.
You know, because I was scared that I'm going to be beaten. He's not going to believe me that I got robbed.
Yes.
Funny enough, when I got there, I was crying, and I actually explained this to him, and he never did anything. I think that was the first time where I felt like, today I deserve a beating, but he never did.
Yeah.
Yeah. But he was one of those guys that anything that is wrong, anything that I feel like maybe it's uncomfortable, I know I'm going to get a beating. Dude, you know, Kokas, when there's always a house in a little green grass,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So his punishment will be, you need to water this grass until like it's waterlogged. Like I need to, and when I put my foot on the grass, and my shoes needs to be wet.
Yeah.
And I used to use a bucket, dude. Like I would pour that thing. Yo, my God.
I mean,
and when he leaves for work, because he needs to leave around 6 in the morning, he'll lock the house, and then I need to be outside, and I'm going to school at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
So I need to stay 2 hours outside. Now I got winter. But go guys, I can only toilet it till it's a good thing.
Yes, yes, yes.
You know those ones. So I'll go there and actually chill in that toilet until 6 o'clock. Because I didn't want anybody to know what I was going through. So imagine as a kid and having to go to school and still concentrate in the class. It was very difficult for me.
But you were like in prison, bro.
No, I was. Prison breaking it's about gun.
Take a Schofield.
Let's go to you being a street kid, bro. So how was that like? Like you never knew where your next meal was. Like,
yeah.
Who were you chilling with? What was going on, bro?
Look, in the hood, there's always going to be that kid that always fucks up, right?
Okay, yeah.
And I went to him, right? I was like, hey, bro, I'm in this situation.
Mm.
He's like, nah, don't worry, I'll help you out.
Mm.
So we actually find a place where we can actually hide and put out my bags and clothes all there.
Okay.
And then he's the one that actually started teaching me the trades of, you know,
How to survive
and how to find food. So we went to Florida Park. You know, Florida Park, that's where families will go out there and have a lunch,
picnic,
and then we'll go through those bins actually to try and get food. And then when you come back in the hood, because I always had many clothes, all changed, so nobody would know exactly.
Yay.
So people, when they saw me, they still thought that I was still staying with my dad, yeah. But I wasn't.
Who were you sleeping?
Hey, my bro, in the field somewhere.
Yeah.
There was a big hole like this, so we had to go under it, and then we'll cover it with plastic so nobody will see. So when we leave in the morning, we'll actually make sure that, you know, our clothes are safe there. But we'll do that every day.
This is crazy.
And then washing?
Nobody gives a fuck about washing.
But
I'm more concerned about food. No, I understand. Who cares? But
priorities.
Yeah. The priority is food.
Yeah.
And imagine that time during the week, all the kids are in school. Mm. And when you go to Florida Park, nobody's there during the week because people normally come there over the weekend.
Mm.
So during the week, it becomes a problem to find food. Weekends, it's fine because people come to the park and have the picnics.
For sure, for sure.
But during the week was more stressful and difficult for us to find food. But we'll make a plan. We always made a plan. But also, it taught me how to go a night without eating food, because I'll go a couple of days without eating
food.
What's
the longest you went?
3 days.
3 days, dog.
Yeah, 3 days.
And you're a kid.
And I'm a kid, and I'm 8.
You know,
even now when I'm driving, when I see these kids, they always remind me of myself, because I know some of those kids don't know anything. They don't deserve to be here.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And at that time, I didn't understand why I was here. I have a brother and a sister and a mother that are still alive, and I've got a family, because we're all staying in the same street. Why can't they take me in? What is it that with me that it's so problematic that when they see me, they see hatred? So that's how I felt. I felt like my family hated me.
Yeah.
And I was okay being a street kid, because at that time I didn't know better.
So when did your mom come to rescue you?
I think after a couple of months, she came back.
Yeah.
And she rescued me. But the problem is, after she rescued me, she dumped me where my sister and my brother were growing.
Okay.
Like, that's a family house. She dumped me there and then she left again. So now I'm in this environment that I know nothing about. I don't know. I'm not used to my sister or my brother.
And they probably hate you because you're taking the biggest piece.
What the biggest piece? I never got shit, dude. So I'm in this family that I don't know anything about. They're supposed to be my family, and this is new to me, so I need to readjust, right? And with that readjustments, because now you're the youngest in the family. Now you start doing stuff that I normally didn't do at my dad's house.
Yeah.
Like, now you're getting punished for. I think my great grandma didn't like me as well.
Yo.
So it was a problem, and that was her house.
Oh.
So the punishment will come through still. So I felt like I was still trapped in that place as well, where there was no love, no encouragement, no nothing.
And you never thought about going back to the street?
I think I was scared.
Okay.
I think I was scared, and with the punishment, I think it was something that I was so used to. I felt like I can survive this because I survived. My dad was worse, so I can survive this. So let me see this through and see what's going to happen. But also my escape or my therapy at the time was football. Whenever I'm playing in the streets, I wish the lights not to come on because I know that, you know, when I have to go back home and it becomes a problem, you know. And I think that was one of the situations where it really affected my childhood. Yeah.
Like, if someone listening to this might think you had a very traumatic childhood, no?
Yeah.
But in hindsight, are you glad all those things happened because they made you who you are?
Yeah, I'm glad in a way, because now it forced me to develop a certain character.
Yeah.
Survival mode, all
yes.
the time. Independence. But later on.
And the industry you need to survive.
Yes, but also in coming to that later on in my career, that became a problem to other people that were surrounding me, Because now I'm in this survival mode. I'm very cagey, I'm very protective of what I am or who I am, knowing exactly where I come from. So to other people it looks like I'm very arrogant. But I understand where I come from, because I need to fight for everything. Because I fought for everything that I had. That I had.
And you don't want to go back, bro.
I don't want to go back. So for me, other people that I was playing with, they off-season, they had a place to go.
Yeah,
I can go and visit my mom. I've got my home. I didn't have a place to go. So for me, football wasn't just because I knew the game. It was survival for me. I knew that if I failed, I've got nowhere else to go.
It was your home.
It was my home. So I had to do everything that I can to actually survive this game. So that's why I played so differently. That's why people thought that I was so arrogant. It was because for me, it was survival. It wasn't because I wanted fame, no money. It was survival.
And when did you start City Pillars, ne?
I started Rio Stars, actually.
Rio Stars, oh.
Yeah,
okay.
I got recruited. I was 17 going for 18. I got recruited by Rio and Chico Daba. They had a team in Petersburg. So once I left, I knew then that I don't want to go back. You know, I said to myself, no matter what happens, I'm not going to go back. I'm not going to go back. And that's what I did. I fought and then I struggled, yes. I remember at Rio Stars, dude, my first paycheck was 2,000 rands.
Yeah.
And we were staying at a complex where I need to pay rent of 1.6.
Sure.
So I'm left with 400 bucks.
Yeah, yeah.
And on the 400 bucks, they're giving us contract phones where I need to pay 300 every month. So I'm left with 100 bucks.
Yeah. What year is this?
What year is this?
I think it's 2001 or 2000. So basically, I'm not earning anything.
Yeah.
But I'm training like I'm the most earned. I train like I've got so much money, or like I was working very hard because I knew where I wanted to be. Yeah. I knew that this is an opportunity. It's not going to be easy, but I have to go through this. Because at the time also, I didn't know how much a player should be earning.
Of course.
So for me, having 2,000 rand coming into your account was my first time. I didn't have a bank account. So those opportunities that were given to me by Rhea and Chico, I'm forever grateful for those.
Yeah.
You know, and look where I am today.
And where does City Pillars come knocking?
City Pillars came through when, because at the time, the PSL had 18 teams.
Okay.
And then they had to cut down to 16 teams. So Rhea Stars got sold.
Yes.
And then there were 16 teams. Okay. So then all the players that were playing with the Rhea Stars, like Lekwatis and all that type of players, Tapololia, they went to Orlando Pirates. So I didn't have a team. So City Pillars was the team that we actually played with so many friendlies. So they acquired my services. So I had to go play for them then. Then I played for Rio for City Pillars, I think for 2 or 3 years or so. Then I came to the PSL.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And how was that like?
It was, I think I played my best football there.
For real?
Yeah. Wow. Look, imagine from 2 grand.
Yeah.
Not even 2 grand, from 100 bucks. Right?
Yeah, 100 bucks.
Imagine from 100 bucks, right? And then I get to City Pillars where they're saying, how much you want to earn? And I'm like, what do you offer me? They're like, no, we're giving you 7.5. But at the time, I knew that the highest paid player in the team, I think it was Sam Pam at the time. I think they were earning 14.
Sam Pam.
Yeah, I think they were earning 14.5.
Yeah.
Right? And that's big money in NFD at that time.
Yeah.
And I was like, no, I want 14. They're like, okay, cool, sign here.
Yo!
Imagine from
100 red.
From 100 red to 14,000. So that was a huge jump.
Yeah.
So I was happy. That's why I'm saying I think they are playing my best football, because also they put me at the lodge where I never paid for any
accommodation,
nothing. They bought me a car. So I played my best football because they took really good care of me.
So what are you doing with the 14,000? Chicken licking?
Dude. I was buying clothes. because I never had anything new.
So
I couldn't wait to come back to Joburg because that's where I want to buy clothes. Because in Tzaneen, there's nothing there. So come back to Joburg and buy clothes and go back.
Are you buying for that friend of yours, the one you used to be street kid with?
No. That guy, we actually, the last time I saw him was when we were street kids. After that, I don't know what happened to him.
Oh, for real? To this day?
No, to this day.
Oh, wow.
To this day. He was one of those guys that was naughty.
Yeah, you're probably in prison somewhere.
Yeah.
Yeah, but anyway, carry on.
So I couldn't wait to come to Joburg and buy clothes. Yeah. And funny enough was, I end up being the guy that, because in NFD, sometimes you're not getting paid in time. So I'll borrow people money.
Oh, okay.
Because at the time I was the youngest player that was earning so much. Mm. So other guys, when they have shortage of money, I'll give them money as well. Yeah. Because the owner of the team was treating me so well. You know, and for me, I was like, okay, if certain things that I need to do for the club, for the spirit of the team, I'll do it. Yeah, and then I became a captain for the longest time for that club. So I think I played my best football there. And when I left, I actually told them in advance, in the season before, I said, this is my last season and I need to go back to play in the PSL because I felt that I was ready. Yeah. And that season is actually when City Pillars was paying me, Celtics was also paying me.
Celtics?
Yeah. They were paying me because they wanted me to come and play for them.
Oh, yes.
So they were giving me money every month, the salary in every month for me to come and play for them. Yeah. So I was earning double salary. So I had money.
Damn, dog.
So I had nice money. And I played. I won Football of the Year in NFD. And then it was time for me to leave. And I realized also that time, because there was so much hype, that Celtics was not a place for me to go.
Mm.
Unfortunately.
Mm.
Then I was supposed to go to Sundowns and then I got hijacked by SuperSport.
Mm.
Then I played for SuperSport and then everybody knows what happens after that.
Who was it?
The money they were giving you, didn't now they say, we gave you money to come to our team? They not want it back now.
No, but I think at the time also, the fortunate part on my side was Celtics changed ownership as well. Jimmy was no longer the owner. Because Jimmy was the guy who was giving me money. So I think that also gave me an opportunity.
So they was like, what money?
I don't know no money.
I don't know anything. So
we get into SuperSport.
Yeah.
Who's there that you look up to?
I think it was
Wait, but before SuperSport, man, didn't Joma Sono try to sign you?
He did. Yo, shit. The Joma story. Jomo bought my clearance from City Pillars.
Yes.
Right? So I'm going around having conversation with all the teams. Orlando Pirates, I'm having conversation. All the teams, 16 teams. I'm having conversation with all of them.
They all wanted you, dog.
Yeah. So I'm going to my sister's house. At the time, I didn't have a place to go. So I'm going to my sister's house. I'm like, hey, dude, I don't know what to do. I don't know which team to play for. Right? And Jomo calls me and then he says, let's meet. Of course, it's Jomo Son.
It's Jomo Son, you got it.
Yeah, and then I go and meet Jomo. Jomo's like, dude, you know that I've got your clearance, right? I said, no, I didn't know. It's like, yeah, I've got your clearance. We're supposed to sign you. I'm like, okay. And at the time, Jomo was taking players overseas. And he actually said to me, you're not going to stay long in my club. You know the type of player that plays in my club?
He's done it. Maruwaru.
Yeah, he's done it for so many players. Yeah. So he's like, no. Your salary is going to be 14,000.
If I rather 14.
So he's saying, your salary is going to be 14,000. And we're going to sign for 2 years. Come tomorrow, I'm giving you 100,000 signing on fee.
Sure.
Bruh, 14,000 was earning in NFT. It's the same money that was earning.
Yes.
And I'm like, yes, it's a great opportunity, but I want to go to a team where it plays the football, the kind of football that I want to play.
Yes.
You know? And I want to, and also I'm looking at 2010 World Cup as well.
That's in my mind.
I want to be playing. Yes. You know, I want to be given that opportunity. And I felt like at the time, Jomo was in the right club for me.
Mm.
You know, but honestly, if Jomo was the only club that wanted me, of course I would have signed for Jomo.
Of course, yeah.
But at the time, I had so many teams that wanted me. Look, I had an opportunity to join London Pirates straight. Mm. I had an opportunity to join Kaizer Chiefs straight at the time. I had an opportunity to join. Yeah, I had an opportunity to join Sundowns straight at the time. All of them I had conversations with.
And who were you supporting as a kid?
No, Kaizer Chiefs.
Yeah. Oh.
And for me is, I've never joined a team based on how much they're paying me. We never had discussion about, guys, how much are you paying me? It was never the conversation. For me at the time, because I had an opportunity to re-stars, I was so young, I was never given an opportunity to play. I wanted a team that would actually give me an opportunity to play. All I wanted was, give me a platform to play.
Mm.
And I felt like at the time, Kaizer Chiefs were not ready, or Orlando Pirates with too many players there, Sundowns had too many players there, so it's going to be the same story of Real Stars. And where I come from NFD, I just won Football of the Year. I need to play regularly.
Yes.
You know, I'm so used to playing regularly. So SuperSport was the best choice for me.
And who was the coach that, when you go to SuperSport?
Coach Pizzo.
Pizzo!
Yeah.
First time you met him? What was
happening? First time I met him, when Pizzo was still staying at the South, he used to, when Real Stars was sold, Pizzo used to take me from Southgate to come to Pretoria to train with him when Thomas Madikgakgé retired. So he wanted me to replace Thomas Madikgakgé, right? So when I got to SuperSport, there was so many talented players and I was still insecure with my play.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. So I got there, see all these guys training. I'm like, yo, fuck, I'm not gonna make it here. You know? And then I stopped training and then I ran away. Then Spito never spoke to me ever again.
Sure.
Until 2006, where he spoke to me, and then that's how I joined him. But we always had a different personality with Pizzo. I think my personality and him always clashed. Because even at SuperSport still, there were, we used to fight a lot. We used to fight a lot, a lot, a lot, yeah.
So why did you leave SuperSport then?
I wish I knew, eh? Here's what happens, right? I'm playing for SuperSport. End of the season, the new coach is coming. Pizzo is going to the national team. The new coach is Gavin Hunt. Yes. So Gavin Hunt calls me into the office. He says to me, where do you want to play? Which position do you want to play? I say, I don't know, coach. It's up to you where you want to play me.
Yeah.
And then he says to me, there's a lot of similar players in SuperSport.
Yeah.
Right? So I don't know where to play you.
Yeah.
You're not a winger.
No,
you're not a number 10.
Yeah.
You're a half-half.
Yeah.
You know?
And box to box.
So that made me feel like he doesn't want me there, right? So we're going to, and at the time, there was a friend that we're supposed to go to in Australia. We actually went there. We played a game, we lost 4-0.
Sure.
So overseas, what they do is like 80-something minute, they announce man of the match. So,
yes.
I was announced as man of the match, and we're losing 4-1.
Wow.
So after that, we had to go to a dinner with a club as well, you know.
And the players and whatnot.
Yeah. So I think one of the management guys from SuperSport was so angry that he even said, why would players be happy for men of the match when you lost 4-0, 4-1? And it was a friendly.
Ooh,
right?
Okay.
So for me, it felt like I'm no longer wanted here. I had a conversation with the coach about where he wants to play me. I'm getting a man of the match here. There's problems here. And then when we came back from Australia, we went to Limpopo, where they used to make all those tournaments in Yana. I became the top goal scorer and the player of the tournament then.
This is preseason,
and still there was a lot of problems.
Jeez.
As to where we want to play him, you know. And I remember Gavin saying to me, if there's an offer for you, we'll listen.
Whoa, that's
in
clear.
Football, that tells you.
Yeah, you know,
we don't even need for you.
Yeah. So then.
And you are Tico fucking Moody's.
Dude, I just been introduced to the national team.
Hey.
And I felt like, okay, cool. And I remember when I was still trying to figure out which team to join, or which team to consider, rather, Pizzo called me, Coach Pizzo. He called me, is like, go to Orlando Pirates. And I'm like, dude, I'm done. It's a done deal with me and Sundowns. Like, no, go to Orlando Pirates. I said, why? He says, I know Orlando Pirates has a lot of players, but none of them plays like you. You're playing differently. You're going to play on basis that you play different than them.
Yeah.
And I listened to him because this is a guy that coached him. This is a guy that gave me opportunities. So I listened to him. That's
and he's still looking out for you.
Yeah. So that's how even with all the fights that we had.
Yeah, it's the differences.
Wow.
Yeah,
man.
So that's how I joined Orlando Pirates.
Yo, no. I'm a Chiefs fan, but you know, I think you made the right decision going to Pirates.
No, but I was
you
waiting.
Killed
for,
it, dog.
No, but I was waiting for Chiefs, though.
You were waiting for
Chiefs.
Yeah,
because you support Chiefs.
No, I support Chiefs. I'm waiting for Chiefs to come. Listen, I don't care how much Chiefs are going to pay me.
Sure.
Chiefs, anybody that is an official, let him come and speak to me. I've spoken to all these teams and I've spoken to officials. You know what Kaizer Chiefs does? They're sending a player to actually come and talk to me. So I felt disrespected.
Yeah,
of course, it is disrespectful.
And I was like, if Orlando Pirates can actually send officials to come and talk to me.
Yes.
It's like getting fired by an SMS.
Yeah, exactly. You know, so that's what happened. That's why I didn't join Chiefs. Mm-hmm. But I was actually waiting for Kaizer Chiefs. That's the only reason why I didn't join Chiefs, because of how they dealt with the situation. And I was waiting for them.
Who was playing the Chiefs at the time? Because I know the old guys, man. We're more
at the time. Yeah, they were still there. Romo Kizama and all the type of guys. Wow. And I think Spew was in his second season there, Chiefs.
Oh, yeah.
So there was a lot of guys that were still new, younger ones, but all the guys were still there. And then they sent Spew Mkonza at the time, because I played with him at Rear Stars.
Yeah.
They sent him to actually come and talk to me.
Yeah.
No disrespect to Spew, but I felt disrespected.
Yeah, yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And I felt like...
And you're professional.
Yeah, I'm like, oh, fuck it, I'm not going to go join Chiefs.
Hey, which one is this one? When you get to a lot of Pirates and then you see the Moody, are you not like, hey, which one is this one? See, I can't like it, man.
Look, man.
You know, before you start, Nick, I didn't believe that existed, eh?
No.
I thought people were lying, bro.
It exists, it happens. Because the thing is, you join a lot of Pirates, you're such an excitement, very young boy from Soweto, but struggled so much, now playing for one of the biggest clubs in the country,
yeah.
Right? I'm excited, I'm playing for the team. But I got to understand later on that every club, it's got its own rituals.
Right? Yes.
Every club does things in its own ways.
Yeah, their own culture.
Yeah, and with what happened, what was happening at Atlanta Pirates at the time, it wasn't a regular base type of thing.
Yeah.
We lose, we're like, we're bringing somebody. we 2 wins in Yana, and then that person's not there anymore. We lose a couple of games, we bring in somebody. So it was one of those situations, and it was always different. And for me, it was scary because it's something new.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
I played for SuperSport, nothing like that happens.
Nothing
I
like
played
it.
for Rear Stars, there was nothing like that. I played for City Pillars, nothing was like that was happening. I was in the Bafana setup, nothing like that was happening.
Yeah.
And I was shocked, dude. If anybody has an image of me playing for Atlanta Pirates, they will realize my socks were always tapered here because I used to cut them because there was always stuff in it.
It was the Muti.
I don't know, Chief.
Yeah.
Wow, man. So I'll cut them and use my smaller socks underneath.
Yeah.
Right. And that's how I would play because socks are always wet. That's how I would play. And
so you can't say I don't want to use this Muti.
No. A lot of guys tried. They never survived.
They got benched.
it's either they never played regularly or they were not part of the team anymore.
Apart from the putting things in the socks, what else were they doing to you or expected you to do? Giving you things to wash with?
Yeah, we'll bath. No, seriously, we'll bath. You know, we'll bath.
It's in the book. They used to bath in, what's the black?
Yeah, I think it was something that was black in it. We'll bath just before the game, just before we go to the game, we'll bath. And the problem was, look, as long as something...
I'm telling the crazy story of... You used to bath and then go straight to the...
To the game. Because we'll bath, right? A night before.
Yeah.
And go back to our rooms, take a shower, sleep, we'll lose the game. And they're like, fuck. Clearly, these boys are not doing what they're supposed to do. So now,
Niwashi mood.
Yeah. So on the game day, after having a pre-match meal, as we're about to go to the bus, we need to pass that room, take a bath, get into the bus, go straight to the stadium. You there? You there in the ground? You're doing this. It's itchy. But it's I strongly believe I'm not sure, I highly doubt those are things that are still happening right now.
Yeah.
But at that time, many a team that we played against, they were doing stuff.
Yeah.
You'll see in the dressing room, there'll be smoke somewhere.
Yeah.
So a lot of teams were doing stuff. So for me, it as much as it was foreign to me, but it wasn't something that not spoken about in the corridors. We knew certain teams were doing such a thing. Especially when I'm going to tell you this. I remember, fast forward, I remember when I was at Sundowns, we played Kaizer Chiefs.
Yeah.
And that's the season that we won our first trophy. I won my first trophy.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
We're playing Kaizer Chiefs. So in the Kaizer Chiefs in the town in FNB, there's a door that you're not allowed to walk through. It's only Kaizer Chiefs personnel that are allowed to go through. It's always locked there. So what we did was, as we did pitch inspection, I came back, I took a little bit of grass, and then I mixed Powerade with Barocca, so it changed the color.
Yeah.
So it became green, it became something weird.
Yeah.
So as we walked out to play, I was pouring that thing on the ground. People went crazy. Yo. It nearly caused us a problem.
Yeah.
Like they started fighting us. What are you pouring here? Because I was just trying to play with the side.
And
we had to win the game to be in position one. And if we sustain those victories, we're going to win the league. And we won that game.
Yo.
And I scored that goal. I'm sure they're like, that's the Muti that I use.
Do they use Muti overseas?
Like I highly doubt.
Brazil and them.
No. I think, look, I've internationally, the Bafana, I've played with so many countries.
Yeah.
You know what these countries do? Like, I remember we played against Portugal in Switzerland.
Yeah.
It's got cold.
Yeah.
Ronaldo's there. Yeah. Very tall guy. The first time seeing Ronaldo, Ronaldo's this tall guy.
Yeah.
And then, like, that Portuguese team with your Deco, top, top player.
Yeah.
Pepe and all that.
Figo.
Yeah.
Figo.
No, no, Figo. No, Figo, no. No, yeah. I'm not Previous that old.
Yo, Figo, free. Where are you? Old man, that
guy.
Figo.
What's wrong with you? So we're playing them at the tunnel. Né? A lot of our guys started asking for T-shirts. Right, so it pissed some of the Portuguese players because yes, before the game, you already in the tunnel you're asking for jerseys.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, guys.
So we're singing loud, wah wah wah, wada wada wada. Those guys are keeping quiet, nothing. And normally we always say to ourselves, the more we sing, the higher we sing, we're building confidence in going to the game and actually win the game.
Yes.
Fuck it, we lost. And then I remember saying after the game, like, guys, we must stop singing. Because really wasting so much energy. These guys are keeping quiet.
They're zoning in.
Yeah. So it depends on which country you're playing against.
Yeah.
Like Brazilians will have their drums and all that type of stuff. Yeah, they're very, you know, sambas. But when you play like your European countries, it's quiet. Mm. Everybody's focused on the game.
Yeah.
So for us, we sing, and we still lose. What's the point? let's stop singing, guys. Let's go play. That's it. Fuck this singing.
Back to Pirates.
Yeah.
Jersey number 10, did it ever get resolved?
It did, actually. Mm. To be honest with you, I remember I was in the meeting with them. They said Jomo approved to allow me to use the jersey number 10. But at the time, I was in so much fight with Atlanta Pirates, I didn't care anymore.
Oh,
I wanted to leave. I didn't care anymore about the jersey number.
Yeah.
I think if that jersey came earlier, I would have loved to wear that number.
Yeah.
You know, it's a very iconic number, London Pirates, and I'm still proud and happy that you know I was offered that jersey. Mm. You know, and it just it came at the wrong time. No, the thing is like, not really, but because I knew where I come from.
Mm.
You know, and I've got so many hairs to feed.
Mm.
You know, and the only tool that I have is football, and this is an opportunity. I play. Look, when you're young, when you're still in the location, wherever you are, you always wish to play for big teams in the country.
100%.
Now you're in the big teams. You wish to play in a national team. Now you're in a national team. You wish to play overseas.
Of course.
So the opportunity came for me to go overseas, and then it didn't happen. So for me, I felt like I'm still in prison.
Yeah.
Like, what is it that I need to do for me, for my extra, for things to go right for me? Why should I always fight for things?
Which English teams wanted you?
In England, it was West Brom.
West Brom.
But
in the EPL.
In the EPL. And then in Spain, I think it was Villarreal or something. I'm not sure.
It was a big deal.
Yeah, and I'm not talking about your Danish league, your France. I'm not talking about that, because those were teams that wanted me. But I'm talking about the biggest
leagues.
You know, leagues. Mm. You know, and I remember having this conversation. They said whenever there's a team that comes in and look for you, but it's a footballing and country or whatever the case may be, or the league is good, will allow you to leave. And when those teams came through, still nothing happened. Can you imagine what it does to me?
Psych. Why didn't they let you go, bro?
I still don't know till this day. And it affected me in a way that I started hating football, right?
Mm.
And hating football meaning I'm not putting 100% in anything that I do in the game. And then now the fans look at me as a person that now that we made him who he is.
Yes, yes.
Now we made him who he is, he thinks he's better.
Yes.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, yes.
And at that time I didn't have a platform to actually come out and say, but guys, this is the situation that I'm in.
There was no Twitter, no social media.
There was nothing like that.
Mm.
So it was one of those situations where I had to actually go in, still train, and being told, I remember the coach telling me that the office said you're not supposed to come and train until you go to the office first. The office needs to give you a green light for you to come and train. I go to the office, no, nobody's here.
Mm.
I go home. Mm. When I'm at home, the journalists will go to the training, and then the next day I'll be in the newspaper saying I went AWOL.
Mm. Because they control the media.
Exactly. So it was one of those situations where it was very, very frustrating for me. And the fans as well, they didn't understand what I was going through. And I highly doubt that people actually cared what I was going through.
Yeah.
So for me, I had only one thing to do, was to drink, bro.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, what else can you do,
yeah,
bro?
So it was, and I didn't have a father figure, remember? So I didn't have anybody to go through to and actually try and explain this thing. And I highly doubt that there was a South African footballer that went through the same thing. Mm. I don't know at the time. So there was nobody that I can go to and actually advise me as to how to handle this issue. Right. So
before we get to the drink, that makes. Do you understand? Do you think you know why they didn't let him go? That makes no sense, bro. Because other players were going overseas.
Yeah. Before I went to Orlando Pirates, Benedicto Villegas went overseas.
Yeah.
Chansa went overseas. So I knew that
it's possible.
It's possible.
Possible.
Yeah. But
what do you think happened? So.
I'm not sure.
Do you think Ivan Koza didn't want him to leave because he was playing so well for Pirates?
Yeah. Possibly.
Maybe that's highly possible, but. It was not the conversation that we had.
Mm.
Look, when I arrived at Pirates, I remember saying, I would wish to go and play overseas. They said, if you do well here, trust me, you'll go overseas.
And the money makes sense. It's pounds. It's euros. Bruh.
And the worst part is all those emails that we sent into the club with all the numbers, I was CC'd in them. So I could see the numbers.
And they're going to benefit financially also.
Bruh, fuck that. I was going to benefit more.
Maybe that's why.
You know, curtains.
Bruh, and I'm looking at the situation like, dude, I'll buy my mom a house.
Yes.
I see the numbers. I look at the numbers. The numbers are crazy. Compared to where I was,
yeah.
The numbers were nice. And I'm like, okay, cool. I said to them, guys, listen, I can even sign a pre-contract right now.
Yes.
But if anything bad happens for me, I don't succeed overseas, I'll come back and play for you guys.
For sure,
Let's
sure.
Let's sign
for
that
sure.
right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, yeah.
Just allow me to go. And within that season, they allowed a player to go overseas and trial for Spurs.
Mm.
I think it was Innocent Ndledla. Went on to trials. And none of the teams that wanted me wanted trials. They just wanted me to do medicals and sign.
Hey.
No trials.
Yeah, they were sure. They wanted.
No wonder you were frustrated, dog.
Man, that's frustrating.
If I didn't take drugs, then.
Yeah, bro, yeah.
Because it was all for them. I remember, you know, what it's about Calabash.
Yeah.
Calabash was the club where drugs were taken, like, it's easy.
Mm.
So it was clubbing Calabash. Trust me. You know when you're in the lowest of low? People actually can sense it or can see it.
Mm.
They start offering you this type of stuff. I was offered drugs.
Mm.
But because I've always had this fear, you know, I ran away. I was offered so many things, dude. I'll run away. And I would prefer to go home and drink indoors than do it out there. You know, even in the club, you'll see me. You'll never see me drunk. I'll be there enjoying. But when I get home, because I was so frustrated and I felt so caged and this is what I love. I'm not playing this because, you know, I'm playing this for survival, you know? And when that opportunity was taken from me, I didn't know what to do. But if I knew what I know now, I would have obviously dealt with the situation differently.
And the
probably
chairman?
Maybe my contract would have maybe a buyout clause, something like that, you know?
And you also blaming your manager at the time.
No, we went 2 years without talking to each other. I hated him at the time. You call at the complex, you know, the gates, they'll call.
For sure.
And they say, Sbanban is at the gate. I'm like, I'm not around. They'll make sure that they open for him. Trust me.
Yeah.
I'll lock the doors.
What happens as a soccer player when you take cocaine? Does it affect your body or can you still play on the Monday?
I don't know per se, but with...
Because Maradona was on it.
Yeah, a lot of guys as well in the PSL were on it. But I think there was a case a couple of years ago where Jumailo was suspended. I think for 4 years, or was banned actually for four years not to play as well. I think a lot of guys that took it, I don't know the feeling.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know the feeling of being high, but for me, it was just scared because, look, I didn't want to do anything that would jeopardize my career.
Did you ever play drunk?
Huh?
Did you ever play drunk?
No. No, but I'll go to training hanging.
Hey, you're strong.
I'll be hanging. But also, it's not because there's a game. Look, I was very calculative as to when I go out.
Yeah.
Like, I'll go out and party hard knowing that tomorrow probably the game is on the other week. So I'll go there. And the thing is, like, with me, I always used to train with a mask, right?
Okay.
I was one of those weird guys, either the beanie or a mask.
Yeah.
So the mask played a better role when I was hanging.
Yeah.
So nobody could actually smell alcohol. So I wear a mask and.
Bro, imagine training while you're hanging, bro. You're strong.
It's worse. No, it's worse. It's worse. But it's just that when you're in that situation, I think because also the thing is in football there's no platform for people or for players to actually to express their feelings, the depression.
Yes,
because in football, depression doesn't exist. Nobody speaks about it.
Yes,
you know?
Yes.
And then we always find excuses as to utawa imali or fame, na 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 na. So there was no conversation of depression. So when most players, when they get depressed.
Yeah,
they tend to do
to the bottle or something.
Something,
whatever,
you know, because at the time, because you look, you're a machine. You need to play. That's it. Don't talk. Don't ask questions. Nothing like that. And when you start asking questions, you become a problem. You're disturbing the team.
So, Krenkren, you know? Pirates got you to drink
heavily.
That's crazy.
Not that I wasn't drinking, but it got me to drink heavily. Because look, I went years without people knowing that I was drinking. I'll go to a club, proper. I'll buy what I buy Red Bulls. You know, and I pour whatever that I was drinking in a Red Bull can. So whenever you see me holding a Red Bull can, you think, that guy's so focused.
Oh,
You know, discipline on fleek.
Yeah, because I was so scared to show people that I was drinking.
Yeah,
because at
the
time I had so many responsibilities. Look, dude, I'm the star of the Solano Pirates. There's responsibilities, you know, coming with that label as well.
Yeah.
And then in this now team I'm playing there, and I've got endorsements as well.
Endorsements.
You know, so for me, I couldn't party like other normal players would party. I wouldn't date like normal players would date.
Yeah.
I wouldn't do certain things that normal players would do. So I never really enjoyed my peak. Because when I was at the peak, I felt like that on its own imprisoned me because I couldn't do shit.
And you're scared you're going to lose everything.
You're so scared.
My dad at home used to have his car.
Fuck that.
And what about now the family that wasn't treating you well at your peak? Are they coming back? Are you guys fine?
Of course. Look, I think the first time my mom saw me play was I was playing for Orlando Pirates.
Wow.
He always knew that I was playing the game, but he saw me playing for Orlando Pirates. And at the time also, you the more mature you get, you tend to forgive, man.
Yes.
So I started forgiving my mom. I started forgiving everybody.
Beautiful.
Then I started trying to build that relationship. But still, you struggle a lot because now you really feel like, okay, now I'm this person. Now everybody wants to come back into my life.
Face dog. It needs something now.
Yeah, so that's a little bit of a challenge. But I think the best part was once I started forgiving myself that it wasn't my fault, what I went through, and then I started seeing things differently.
How are you with Ivan Cousin? Are you guys good?
But we're good. I haven't seen him in a long time, but we're good because I remember after winning Champions League with Sundowns, he was one of the delegates that we met at the airport when we landed. So he congratulated me actually.
Yeah. Mm.
So it's I don't think there's a bad blood between me and the Pirates.
Yeah.
But the thing is, I chose to speak my truth.
For sure.
I'm not bashing Orlando Pirates whatsoever.
Yes.
And I'll forever be grateful for the opportunity they're giving me. But I was just telling my truth.
It was your truth.
Yeah. And I still said the same thing about Sundowns. I spoke my truth. I wanted to leave. Like, it's crazy. Nobody wants to leave Sundowns.
Yeah.
It's crazy, especially at the peak that we're at. We're winning so many things, getting so much money. But I wanted to leave because I wasn't happy.
Yeah.
And I'm still working for Sundowns today. So it wasn't because I was bashing Sundowns when I said those type of things.
Yeah.
But I was telling my truth. And my struggle, it's just that I wanted to play football without any struggle. Can I play, you know, without all these issues, without all this politics? Give me the ball, let me play.
Fuck, man. How was Bafana Bafana? Because I remember, where did you watch the World Cup, the first game?
The first Innisfree Park.
I was there as well.
Yeah, I was there.
We were broadcasting live. I was still working at YFM.
Yeah.
So we're broadcasting live from there, and Innisfree Park was packed.
Dude.
I've never seen it that packed.
Yeah.
And then when Tshabalala scored that first goal,
that was a beautiful
goal. We thought we won the World Cup.
Yeah. But the feeling was there. No. That was a feeling. It was crazy.
How was it for you, bro, as a player? Because like you were the poster boy for the World Cup.
Look, then I realized that my dream actually came true.
Yeah.
Not only that I was part of the national team or part of the squad that was in the World Cup, I played. So my dream actually came true. And to look at also the players that played in the team, a lot of guys were local. So at the time, we were so happy to be part of that.
Mm.
But we didn't understand the World Cup magnitude.
Meh.
We didn't understand.
Yeah, you were still singing.
Yeah, we were still happy.
Dancing with routines.
Of course. It's not a bad thing to do that. But we were still just excited that we're in the World Cup. But we didn't understand how big the World Cup is.
Bro.
I think many players would never understood that until the first game. After the first game, that's when we realized, hey, guys, these are not qualifiers. These are not friendlies. This is a World Cup. So the challenges become so huge. And the thing is also, you're going in such a big tournament. I'm playing local, but all the pressure's on me. The World Cup, for us to survive, for us to go through, Tikom Disa has to do something.
Yeah. Has to perform.
You know, has to perform. Yeah. And that was so much pressure on me. And at the time, I felt like I could carry this pressure.
Mm.
You know, I felt like, you know what,
I'm
fuck it. I can do this. But the challenges were there because I wasn't ready mentally because I was dealing with so many things, but physically I was tip-top shape. Mm. But just the mental part of it, you know, and when people look at those games back, now they realize that actually you didn't have such a bad tournament.
Yeah, yeah.
But then it was like, fuck it, you failed, you know.
Yeah.
But man, when Spirit scored, we also felt like we scored as well. We celebrated. It was such a fun time. I think we all happy.
Bro, it makes sense what you're saying, because I feel like the first game you played, you guys played with no fear.
Yeah.
And then you saw how big this thing is, and then you started like,
yeah,
there was too much pressure.
Yeah.
Because even the last game we were so close, dog.
We were, but I think also it's natural.
Mm.
It's really natural, because you look at the squad that we had. Not many. Can I say experienced guys were part of the team?
Yes.
So most of the guys were made up of local players. Mm. And the local players, most of them are playing in smaller, so-called smaller teams. So they only get pressure when they're playing against big teams, right? So we in this big tournament where now we need to perform, right? And we're performing, you're playing against your Mexico, your Uruguay, your Suarez that are playing week in, week out.
Mm. Edison Cavani.
Yeah, behind 60 to 80,000 fans. Mm, so yeah. This is nothing to them, you know? And for us, it was like, yo, guys, we're representing not only the country, but we represent the continent as well. I think the pressure came back to us, and we struggled to perform the way we performed in the first. Because the first game, I think we really, really performed very well.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But after that, we performed in patches. I think that was the problem, that we really started to feel that. Because after the game, my bro, when you drive back to the hotel, that's when you realize, you're like, fuck. Wow, this is actually huge.
Yeah.
You watch the news, articles. Yeah. Everything was about the World Cup. Everything was about Bafana. So I think the pressure came.
How was it behind the scenes during the World Cup? Like, did you meet any other soccer players like Messi or any other guys?
Never. Look, it was... Look, I don't know how to put this. I don't remember. Look, even when we're exchanging jerseys when we're playing,
yeah.
But I've never been fascinated of exchanging a jersey with a certain player.
Mm.
I had that ego in me, that pride in me,
yes.
That I'm good.
You're like, just as good.
Yeah, but even if I do get your jersey, what am I going to do with it?
Frame it.
No, fuck no. I'm not going to frame any jersey. Even in my house, there's no jersey that has been framed. Like, it's just that for me, it was those type of things. It's just that for me, I was like, I played in the World Cup.
Yeah.
I did this and I did that. I don't need anything that I need to take away from it to remind me of what I did. The stats are there. Everybody saw it that I played in the World Cup. I don't need a jersey that says 2010 World Cup. Everybody knows that I played there.
Yeah.
You know, you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
So even when we played against your Ronaldo, I never asked for any jersey.
Where did you watch the final?
I was probably drunk somewhere. because I was feeling so sad, because at the time I was to blame that we didn't qualify.
Oh yeah.
And because
the media was on.
Yeah, it was on me.
Yeah.
The media was eating me alive.
Yeah.
And I remember as well what I did. Like I was so emotional. I was like, fuck it. I was one of those guys that every time I felt some kind of emotions, I'll try and get something new to buy something, maybe that will make me feel better.
Eh.
I went on and I bought a car.
Is it Jamato?
Yes.
I bought an Aston Martin. I think that was a mistake.
Yeah.
Because people were saying, at the time, they were like, oh, you bought an Aston Martin, which means they got millions from the World Cup.
Mm.
And to be honest with you know how much money we came out of the World Cup? 150,000 rands.
That's it?
That's it.
From the 2010 World Cup?
2010 World Cup. So when we were done playing, people were like, they moneyed nothing, chief.
Sure.
Nothing.
That's peanuts, dog. That's,
but they could have gotten more if they went past the group stages.
Yeah, but
though.
Listen, here's the thing, bro. When you play a tournament, you get a participation fee.
Oh.
Right?
Yeah.
Every club you host, you get money because you're hosting. So when SP appearance, you should be getting a certain fee.
Oh.
Because you got the appearance fee in advance. We got paid per game.
Mm.
So I remember at the time, before the World Cup game started, we had to sign contracts in terms of the bonus. We were fighting for bonuses. It was in the news. We actually signed this contract probably a day before the game, because everybody wanted to be part of the World Cup. Nobody wanted to leave.
Yes.
So we were cornered to sign this contract because we wanted to play the World Cup.
Yeah.
So it wasn't great. It wasn't good bonuses. I mean, when you play a qualifying game, you get 60 grand or 66 grand, something like that.
Mm.
So you go to the World Cup, you're expecting to get 100 grand a game.
That makes sense. Yeah.
And they made a killing.
They made a killing. So it's one of those situation where you're struggling with, after playing the World Cup at home, they're like, hey bro, we know that you got millions, so And I'm like, yo, if only you knew.
Yeah.
It was nothing there. So, but the experience was something else.
During the World Cup, you got a shitload of endorsements, dog.
Yeah.
What are your players saying at that time? Some are getting nothing.
You get a McDonald's deal, some are clowns.
Look, it created a lot of tension. Because, and also the thing is, look at it this way. We're going out because we're doing a lot of activations for Bafana. We're going to different cities and all that type of stuff.
Yes, yes.
Imagine you have 26 to 27 players there, 32, whatever the number it was.
Yeah.
Whenever your name has been called, the crowd shouts louder than anybody else. It used to make me uncomfortable because now we all representing one thing now.
Yeah.
You know, and
it's not your fault, though.
It's not my fault. Yeah. And you look at any national team, though, guys, they will never talk to me. and I was okay with that. They'll never speak to me, and I was okay with that. But I realized it's not because of the person that I am, it's because of what I have.
Yeah.
It because it was new in the country at the time. It was very new. And here I am, a football of the year, having this type of endorsement.
Sure.
And I'm not a talker much, you know. I'm all to myself. He thinks he's better than us, and all the type of things. So it was very uncomfortable for me. But the only time I felt joy was on the pitch, because at the pitch I didn't fucking care. Because the thing is, in South African football, we always used to compete. I'll put myself in there. We always used to compete about women, cars, and houses, and all this material stuff. We never actually compete about what we can do on the pitch. So for me, I'll look at what is it that I don't have, and I'll get worried.
Yeah.
But I know that anything when it comes to the game on the pitch, nobody can tell me anything.
We wouldn't pass it because of you got a McDonald's.
No, yeah, because already they're not talking to you.
No, I wouldn't. No, I don't think that happened. I don't think that happened. And even if it did, but I was one of those guys that was very, 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 very creative. I'll create situations for myself where things like that happens. I'll make sure that I'm in the game still.
Who was the leader in the dressing room? Like when you guys were losing, you'd call everyone and say, hey, fuck you, you're doing this. Hey, do this, Mark, run back.
No, there was a lot of great leaders actually in the national team. But for me, I actually enjoyed the national team when Benny McCarthy was there.
Oh, okay.
Because Benny...
It's got a stand there.
Yeah, Benny was Benny.
Yeah.
And when Benny is around, we know that it's Benny or nothing, right? And when Benny speaks, people listen. And Benny wanted us to win. Benny was winner.
And get paid what you deserve.
Yeah, and when Benny will get the bonuses from national team, we'll give them to security guys. The guy that picks up the bags and all that type of stuff.
Oh,
bro, let me tell you a story about what Benny did one day. This motherfucker. Benny, we're still friends even today.
Yeah.
Benny, we at the airport, duty free. He buys like 15, 16 perfumes.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right? We go there. I think we're playing in Burkina Faso. We play a game. After the game, because Benny had the perfume for everything. For his toes, his water. That's Benny McCarthy. After the game, he left those perfumes in the dressing room. He said, guys, you can take them. Bruh. Players, local players, were taking those perfumes and all that stuff. That's how Benny was, right?
Wow.
And I remember senior guys, you know, there's a toiletry bag, the Louis Vuitton toiletry bag. Back in those days, it was a thing, right? When you have that, you're a professional footballer, right?
And the Beats headphones.
Yes. So Benny in those toiletry bag, you put in boots, bro.
What?
Jeez.
Fuck, I was like, this guy. But honestly, I enjoyed playing with him in the national team. When he was around, there was order. And I think when he was around, there was a lot of respect for him. And we all wanted to play for him.
Mm.
So it was unfortunate that he was not part. I think if he was part of the national team and in the 2010 World Cup, I think we would have played differently. Me personally, because I enjoyed playing with him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I would have enjoyed. But I think he was one of those leaders that, you know, it was very difficult not to notice that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, congratulations, dog. You're now officially off the market.
Yeah. I've been. Seriously, I got married in 2018. But you know, when you do a traditional wedding, then you have to do it this side and also on the other side. But it's just that we never got an opportunity to do it on my family side because I was still staying in Cape Town, playing for Cape Town City.
Oh, so this one is for your family.
Yeah, so I've been. But it's just that when you come out of the media, it's like, he's getting married. I'm like, but I've been there. I've been wearing my wedding ring, but the thing is, like, dude, like the challenge was, I got married, but I never got an opportunity to become a husband.
Because
I got married and then I moved to Cape Town to play. So my wife was still on this side. So for me, it was very difficult to be a husband. So it felt like I'm still a boyfriend and all that type of stuff, long distance relationship.
Why did you move with her?
No, but the type of work that she was doing this side.
Oh, yeah, she's working this side.
And even if she moves to Cape Town, it was, for me, it was not a permanent move to Cape Town. So it didn't make sense for her to actually come and move there. Remember?
My woman would never agree.
But she was willing. But it worked well in the beginning. It was exciting because Cape Town is also like a holiday destination. Yeah, whenever she comes through, we'll do so many things. But I think lockdown hit me so hard that I realized, like, fuck, dude. Like, what am I doing in Cape Town here? Because I've retired already. What am I still doing here?
Yeah.
You know, I need to go back home. I need to be a husband. Because this is my second marriage. I never got a chance to be a husband.
Of course,
you know, so this gives me an opportunity to become a husband. So I had to resign at Cape Town City. I'm like, I moved back to Joburg. And actually, the reason why I resigned was to actually come back and be a husband to my wife.
Is it easy to get a woman when you're a soccer player?
No, of course.
Nah.
Of course.
You no, don't say course. Anything, nah.
No, of course. Look, I remember, KO will kill me for this. I remember when I was with KO and Tsulu. I don't know if you know Tsulu.
Yeah, Tsulu, the manager.
Yeah. With KO and Tsulu at Kong, right? We're chilling there. KO's not drinking. Tsulu's not drinking. And I'm like, ah, fuck. These guys, what are we doing here if you guys are not drinking? So we're chilling there. And my best friend is not drinking as well.
Yeah.
There's four of us. So we're chilling there. So I remember KO saying, hey, Brian, I'm free to make a plan.
Yeah.
You know, Akhtola Stogonyan. And I'm like, bro, you're so pretty. Look at you, you're a handsome dude. You need to get us something.
And you're a rapper.
Yeah. But I also realized then that us as footballers, because music is so important in our lives.
Yeah.
We want to be them and they also want to be us.
Yeah.
So for Rona, I realized that okay, it's easy for them to get a woman. It's so easy. And for footballers, if you're known, it becomes easy. You know, you all these eight girls that are in now,
bro.
You know, it was easy for you to date them, but of course, sometimes it gets tiring as well.
Yeah.
Because now you.
But what is it about soccer players that they like, bro? Because DJs get some ass.
Yeah.
Hip hoppers were getting some ass. Yeah. Man, soccer players have been cleaning since they started kicking balls.
Since they started kicking balls. Look, I don't know what is it with footballers that women like, but for now, I think I experienced it differently.
Yeah.
Because I was never the guy that wanted to date somebody and be known that I'm dating that person. Like I was an ass in a sense that every chick that I dated will feel like she's a side. And I've got a man. At the time, I didn't have a man.
Yes.
Because I didn't want anybody to be comfortable. Because I was so scared that people, when they're coming to me, I don't know where they're coming for. They're coming for Tiko Modiso or they're coming for Tsulu Fe.
Of course.
You know, so I was very, very cagey about that. But hey, man. But
how do you know your wife now? I know this one is the wife.
How did you know she was there for Tsulu Fe?
I fucked up so many times with her.
Oh, yeah. That's how you know. Yeah.
That's how I know. You know? I fucked up so many times. I'm not gonna lie. Look, when I met her, I remember saying, telling her the story that I don't want to get married again.
Sure.
I don't want any kid again, all that type of stuff, right? I remember we went to one of our closest friends' wedding. So we were drinking, they were having fun. We were not told that we were gonna speak. So all of a sudden, now I have to speak. So I grabbed the mic, I didn't want to talk. Congratulated them, said all the nice things. And then all of a sudden there was a switch.
Yeah.
Then I started saying how bad marriages are.
Mm.
Like how fucked up it is. I'll never do that again.
Yeah.
Imagine at the wedding, somebody else's wedding.
Yeah.
So I said all those shit and my girlfriend, at the time she was my girlfriend, she was there. And like it was so embarrassing.
Yeah. Sure.
But that's when I realized like I'm still hurting from what from happened then.
Yeah.
And it was years ago.
Yeah.
I was still hurting from then. But also, and she was there still. Like, and then when things started being serious with me and her, I remember ditching in Cape Town.
Sure.
I went AWOL on her in Cape Town. Mm. We went there for December holidays. Nice, we're chilling, fine, New Year's Eve. I said, listen, I'll come back, let me go, because we're separate.
Yeah.
Like, I booked somewhere with my friend and she booked with her friends and family all the outside. Then I said, I'll come back later on and blah, 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 we'll chill. I left, I never saw her again. Until a few months later. I blocked her on Instagram, I blocked her everywhere else. Because it felt so serious.
Yo.
And I was scared of being in a serious relationship.
Damn.
Right?
Yeah.
So I blocked her. So when we came back, she actually called me a few months later on with a different number and I picked up.
Yeah.
She asked me one question. What did I do? So I started trying to lie, trying to figure out what did I say and all that type of stuff. And then we came back again and then we started talking. And then and then that's when I actually started being honest. Mm. Like I'm scared. Mm. I'm scared of being in a serious relationship because of, I know what happens. Every time anybody comes into my life, they hear. And then they'll leave at some point.
Ish, bro.
You know what I'm saying?
If and my it's not mom, just women, like everybody.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I said. I said, if my mom can leave me, who are you? You know what I'm saying? So I started feeling all those type of things. But, hey, but dude, she's still here.
Hey,
still
bro, there. Congratulations.
You thank got you
a,
very much.
Is it a boy or girl?
It's a boy.
It's a boy.
It's a boy.
Do you remember the position? How he was conceived?
The fuck?
Because you know when you make a boy, you gotta look her in the eye, dog.
Oh, is that where I'm going wrong? No, I look in the other eye, in between the legs. That's my problem.
Look, and what I'm proud about, especially with this pregnancy, is it was actually planned.
Oh wow!
Right,
nice.
And with that was, I got to go to every scan.
Oh, okay.
Because to me, it felt like the first baby. Because all the stuff that I never used to do.
Ish, bro.
Because I was still a footballer. Training and all that type of stuff. So now I did everything.
Yeah.
Like I went to skin. All the feelings that she was feeling, I could feel them. So to me, it feels like a first baby. That's why I'm so excited about it.
Hey, tell me. There's a line in Casper's song, man. I've always wanted to ask you.
Give me back my shit, you suck. No, I'm on my deco mood. This is give me back my shit, you suck hard. Give me back my shit, you suck hard.
Are you that painting, my dog? He wants everything, dog.
Bring it back.
The lotion, the shoes.
Bring it back.
Yeah, I mean, look.
The tampons.
Bring it back. Bloody,
what's wrong
bring
with you?
It back.
No, bloody man. Hell.
As bloody as they are.
No.
You bloody.
Look, I was in a very toxic relationship, right? On Instagram, it looked nice. It looked perfect.
Who's this with?
Lizelle. Yeah.
Lizelle, okay.
Oh, yeah.
On Instagram, it looked good and all the type. So, like, I started doing things out of my comfort zone because I love this woman, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
And
beautiful woman. Oh.
Yeah. Oh, now I've got a type, chief.
Yeah.
I've got a type. So we there. Now you start to learn and understand the person that she is,
sure.
Right?
Yeah.
And she starts to understand and learn the person that I am. So now she's out there and I don't want to be out there.
Yeah, of
right?
course, of course.
So now it becomes one of those situations where... like
and she wants to be out there because that's how she makes her money.
That's, yeah. You know? And then for me, now, and my money, it's made in the soccer pitch, right? Nothing else. And I wanted people to know me as a footballer, nothing else.
Exactly.
You know? And it became one of those situations. I think it became so toxic that... you know, I'd wish not to go home. Like I know that it's gonna be a fight about something. Something's gonna pop up. You know, there's gonna be this.
That's the worst, man.
Yeah, like you and I'm not trying to bash you or anything like that. Like when the parents will come through, because I was known like with the family. So when the parents are in the house, because we were staying together, me and Lisa, when the parents are in the house, she's very different. And I'm like,
where's this one?
Why are you acting?
Who's this?
Yeah.
Yeah, she's so nice and all that stuff. When the parents leave, I'm like, bro, can you please be that person? You know, because that's the woman that I fell in love with.
Yeah.
You know? And it became one of those situations again where my fear kicked in. I was like, God, this is the bullshit again. You know,
she's
I need to bounce. I need to bounce as soon as possible. But it was not that easy. Hey, my bro, we had a huge fight. And I remember she took the pictures. I remember when we started dating, there were pictures in the phone of somebody, I think somebody abused her or something like that.
She had scars and all that type of stuff,
right? So when we broke up, she took the same pictures. The same pictures went to the media and said, I'm beating her.
You lie.
Yeah. And for me, it was scary because at the time, I'm still having these endorsements and all that type of stuff.
And you know, once they say that, it's over.
It's
you can't
over.
Say it's
happening. Can you imagine if it happens now?
GBV,
I'm cancelled, bro.
Proper cancelled.
Yeah. So it was
that's
very,
evil, bro.
Yeah. So it was very toxic for me. And I think it's she's a beautiful person. She's a beautiful woman.
So it was like, if you leave me, I'm dropping the pictures.
No, she never had. She never said that. And for me, when those pictures came through, it wasn't something that I actually expected. You know, because I trusted her. And I remember when all those things happened, she came back to me and wanted to have a conversation with me to apologize. I recorded her, actually.
Yeah.
I recorded all the conversations. But I didn't want to use that because I'm not that guy. I was like, fuck it. Because she was under influence. You know, there was a lot of friends that influenced her to actually do that. Because listen, here's the thing. She's a very pretty woman, right? And to be dumped or something like that, it doesn't sit well with them. She needs to do the dumping, you know?
Yes.
And I think when that happened, because dude, like, I remember we went for holidays.
Yeah.
Like, when our relationship was still rocky, we went for holidays, I think in Seychelles or something like that.
Yeah.
New Year's Eve, we're having drinks, blah, blah. Mm. But I started feeling, but man, this relationship is not working.
Hey.
I'm one person that can't hide or pretend.
Pretend, yeah.
So I said to her, hey, bro, this relationship is not working.
In Seychelles?
Yeah.
New Year's Eve?
Yeah.
You're a dick.
I know, right? It is not working. And it was for the second time. I think we broke up twice in New Year's Eve. I remember the first time I was in Cape Town.
Yeah.
In Cape Town, we went to a party where the celebrities were there. And, I don't see myself as a celebrity, so I don't want to be part of that.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
With the champagnes and all that stuff, pictures. I don't want
to be.
Yeah, and I'm a footballer.
Yeah,
you know, then we need to get there and speak this English. I don't want to be part of that, right? And I told her, like, hey, bro, like, these are your friends. I don't want to be part of this.
Yeah.
You know? And then I left her there in the club, wherever we were. It was New Year's Eve, and then we broke up. Mm-hmm. Came back January, February, fixed things. Then that December, the same year in December again. And I felt like, but I'm forcing this situation. Mm-hmm. Still things are not changing.
Yeah.
Things still are still the same. What am I doing here? Yes. Like, I can't be feeling like I moved in at my own house. I'm staying here. I didn't move in. You understand what I'm saying? I didn't come in with the bags and two bags. I didn't move in. I stay here. You found me here. Why am I feeling so uncomfortable in my own house? It's not gonna work. This relationship is not working.
That's hectic.
And to be fair, also probably maybe there are other things as well on my side that I was doing that would make them uncomfortable.
Yeah.
As well, you know.
Yeah.
But I think both of us share the blame. But it's just that for me, it was one of those situations where it had to end.
And in your first marriage, same thing, was it toxic as well?
No, the first marriage I wasn't ready, to be honest with you. Mm. When it happened, we were not dating. So I was scared to be what my father was to me.
Okay.
She was pregnant.
Eesh.
I decided to marry her because she was pregnant with my baby.
Oh.
I took responsibility of that, you know?
As a man.
So I also wanted to have 7 o'clock, let's have dinner with the family, the kids around. So I wanted to build that because I never had that.
That's beautiful.
But the problem was when we were married, so I learned the person in marriage.
Yeah.
So I didn't know the person at all, you know? And it was very difficult for me because I wasn't really in love with this person. It just,
I don't know why you shop so normal.
I don't know. And I was never that guy.
Yeah.
I was never that guy. Like, really, really. Like, bruh, like, at my peak, do you understand where I was? I was.
Mario Strap.
I was very single. Yeah. So now that to happen, it was very disappointing in my part. But because now it's here, I need to take responsibility.
Of course.
I'm not going to run away from it, you know?
Of course.
But then, it's just that the unfortunate part was once in the marriage, I felt like I'm not in love with this person.
And
I can't be doing this to her.
And you tried, ne?
I tried because, like, I didn't want to go home.
Yeah.
I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to do things with her. Mm. And I'm supposed to be happy in marriage and all that type of stuff. And I was like, sister, let me tell you the truth.
Yeah.
You know, this is the situation. And she honestly understood at the time. And I was honest with her. Because she could also see that this guy is really, really not in love with me. But I loved my kid.
How long were you smashing until she got pregnant? Or you guys had just met? Once!
Yeah, first
night.
Once. But I saw her on the... Is it? But she had a reality show, man.
Yeah.
What is it called?
I think
Footballers' Wives. What is?
Was she on
Disky
Footballers'
Divas.
Wives?
Oh, Disky
Divas.
Ah, she seemed like a sweet person.
No, she is.
Yeah.
She just went in love.
Look. Yeah. But the thing is like, dude, I grew up with no love whatsoever, right? And for me, I learned love as I go. Right, and I wanted, now I'm committed to the situation right now, and I want to love this woman, I want to build a family with this woman, and also probably she's also from a broken home.
Yeah.
But, so both of us are from a broken home. We don't know much about love, so we still trying to figure this thing out. And at the time, I'm having my own stress in football, so it affected our marriage as well, you know. And I didn't want to come back home, and I had I had beautiful friends at the time.
Eish.
Beautiful female friends, and she was so insecure about that.
Yeah, obviously. Yes. Yeah,
and it's obvious. So I was like, I don't want to do this to her. You know, I can't be coming back 3 a.m. and all that type of stuff. So I need to break this.
Your movie, right? Okay, cool. You get the house, you get the car, you get the girls, the it girls, whatever. We've seen that movie so many times in
yeah.
SA.
Yeah.
But in Europe, like in England,
yeah.
these fuckers get married when they're 17.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you seen?
Yeah. Very early.
Because they like, I think the clubs shield them from all the stuff that comes with the fame and the money and being a soccer player.
Yeah.
So there's no structures like that here.
No, there's no structure. In fact, in South Africa, there's no structure whatsoever at all. Because if you do that very early, it helps you to actually grounds you, right? It helps you to focus, you know.
Yes.
Even if you fuck up there and there, but you refocus because there's something that you need to play for.
I mean, Sterling's got 4 kids. He got married when he was 16.
You see,
Raheem Sterling.
So those type of things actually help your career so much. But in South Africa, we don't have a structure.
Yeah.
And also the worst part is when I was at my peak, it's not like I had a high school sweetheart.
Yeah.
You know.
Yes.
It wasn't the case because I left Joburg very early and I came back as I played. So it wasn't that type of situation. And also, when I started, I think it's Super Sport actually. That's when I started being this guy, okay, cool. Let's rock. I mean, how are we weighing?
Yeah.
And there's beautiful women around, and I'll date this one, I'll date that one. I was that guy, still trying to figure out. But I've always been, I remember saying to myself, telling my friends that I'm a 2-year guy. Mm. I'll date you for 2 years. After 2 years, guy, we need to break up.
Yeah,
because it comes too serious. Yeah. I can't.
And we don't want that.
No, people wanted that. So I was a 2-year guy. But yes, as much as at the time, because also if you remember, at my peak, it was a lot of girls that are doing so many great things right now. They were also starting out at the
time. Yes. So it made sense.
So it made sense. So, you know, we were all trying out. We were all, you know, tasting this fame thing.
Yes.
So it was nice and beautiful. But also at the time, I'm married as well.
Yeah.
So I never got to enjoy
it to the full.
To the full.
Fish, dog.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I get that, man.
Yeah.
And then it's true, you guys rock. I heard soccer players rock, so. Because they got stamina, dog.
Ah, they rock.
They rock, man. But 10 rounds.
Yeah, they go.
10 rounds is for people that don't work. We've got to work tomorrow. But here's the thing. I think it's just a stigma, right?
Yeah.
When you grow, you get to understand because the more you have sex, the more experience you have.
Okay, yeah, definitely, right? yes.
And then with the more experience you have, now you start understanding your strokes as well.
Yeah.
You start controlling when to come and when not to come, right?
Yes.
And you start understanding that even if it's sex, it is not really about you.
Yes, right? Yes.
This person needs to be satisfied first.
Uncle.
Yes.
And that's guaranteed. But for her, it's not.
Yeah.
So I need to make sure that she gets satisfied.
Give an assist.
Give an assist.
You can't just call. You need to assist sometimes, right?
So then you get to enjoy it once you understand your strokes. You understand how to actually satisfy the next person and still be satisfied in the midst of all that stuff.
Yeah.
You know, but in the beginning, I was sharp. You were stopping thoughts. And at that time, you actually thinking
you're rocking. Yeah.
And now you're like, fuck, I'm so tired and exhausted. But you actually realize that it is not an extreme sport. You're not supposed to get exhausted and be tired like that. You know, but if then you didn't understand your strokes, you didn't understand the type of energy that you put in. So once you understand that, then you actually start having fun.
Did you know Ronaldinho, before he came, he had to rock?
Brazilians, they'll in the World Cup, they'll bring the woman there so that they can... Ronaldo is the phenomenon. They'll do that.
Wow.
It's Brazilians. It's a culture. That's why prostitution that side. It's normal.
Yeah.
Even if you get you married, they understand that they need to. Some of them they'll actually drink, maybe 2 glasses of wine, whatever. It's a ritual, but it's something that has been understood in Brazil, right? And in England, it's okay to go out a night before and have dinner, and have a glass of wine, as long as you're gonna perform the next day.
Yeah.
Right. It's okay. That's why they play a day after Christmas.
Yes,
it's understood in England.
Yes.
In South Africa,
New Year's,
in South Africa, when because as a sports person, drinking is such a taboo, we're so scared to do all this normal stuff, right?
Mm.
So when we do get an opportunity to drink, we fuck the bottle up.
Yeah, to the max.
Because when I have to come here and actually have a meal and a wine, the fans will start pointing and they're like, yeah. Why is he drinking? Media. He's got a game. Media. You know? Mm-hmm. So it's one of those situations where if you've been given that platform, guys, drink, but drink to a certain level. Trust me. People drink normally, but just that when you have that opportunity, it's like that. And I remember in 2006 World Cup, there was a picture of Zidane smoking in the window.
Yeah,
we regarded Zidane so highly.
Yeah,
when he started smoking, I remember a lot of PSL players started smoking. They're like, if Zidane can do it, fuck it, I'm going to smoke as well. But that's when you realize that okay, Shab, there is this culture. That when you're a footballer, you're not supposed to do
normal human things.
Stuff. Yes. Normal things. And how me as Teko coexist within this culture, right? And then I figured myself out. I was like, because I was so imprisoned by the name Teko Modise and the fame, I was like, fuck it, I'm going to live my life.
Mm.
And the minute I decided to do that, I started enjoying
everything.
Life, everything that
so
I did.
So you couldn't even enjoy the car, the house?
Nothing.
Yo, bro, that's nothing, the worst thing.
Nothing.
Yeah?
Bruh, you know, I remember most of the guys, especially at Supersport, were young. All of us were the same age. When you go out to a groove, ne, they'll bring their girls through.
Yeah.
I'll never come with a girl.
Yeah.
And I remember their girlfriends were like, Tiko, are you straight? I'm like, what do you mean? Like, you never bring your chicks around.
Yeah.
But the thing is, I've always been scared to bring any chick around or go with a chick somewhere because I always felt worried. I'm not supposed to do this. It doesn't feel right with me. Why must I do it?
Mm.
But I always have chicks.
Yeah.
Like we'll go to a groove. After that, there's somebody that I need to pick up and go home.
Of course.
You know, I've always been that guy. So they always used to ask me, when are you not straight? I'm like, straight. Because I wasn't enjoying what other normal players were enjoying because I was so imprisoned with what was going on in my mind, what I want to achieve. And that drove me to become this beast that I never actually really got to enjoy that short space of time.
Yeah.
But once I got through that, I started enjoying. I think Cape Town helped me
a lot
in terms of enjoying that. Because in Cape Town, my girlfriend would come through, we'll do all these normal things. And I'm like, fuck, I missed out on a lot. In terms of traveling as well.
Hey, bro.
You know, traveling,
family things,
small things, family gatherings. I missed out on so much. Yeah. But now I'm enjoying them now.
100%, man. Let's talk about your book. There's some quotes in your book that I want you to elaborate on. Ne?
No stress.
Just quickly. Ne?
Yep.
Money and fame too young in my life without proper guidance and support from family is a sure way to a disastrous ending.
Yeah.
This is like for all the soccer players.
Yeah.
You reckon? Eh?
Yeah. Mm. Because look, you brought up by people that know nothing about money, or you surrounded by people that know nothing about money, and they can't tell you anything better because they don't know anything about money. So now money comes to you, you're this young boy from Kokas, you never know anything about money. You don't know how to use it. The worst thing that I can say to you is as buy a property.
Yeah.
That's it. That's what they tell you. They don't know what goes into buying property, what type of properties to buy, what type of suburbs you need to look at. You know, they're just saying invest in a property.
And then that's it.
And then they leave you like that. So we don't know. There's no proper structure. And also, the worst thing is you look at your English EPL.
Yeah.
There's a sort of like a retirement fund within the league itself.
Yes.
There's a certain portion of money that they take.
Yeah.
In the most leagues in Europe,
a
certain portion of your salary that they take, they put away. At a certain age, they give you that money is a lump.
There's also an agency that tells you, listen, put your money here.
Yeah. But in South Africa, there's no such a thing.
Yeah.
So you get a 22-year-old that has never had money in his life.
Bro.
You're giving him whatever money that you're giving him, you leave him like that.
Yeah.
You expect that boy to behave normally. It's impossible.
It's impossible.
So,
already.
So the system itself,
that's why your book is very influential.
Exactly.
And very powerful.
So that's why I say that the system itself is designed for us footballers to fail.
Yeah.
It's normally for us to fail so that you can come back and beg.
100%.
That's how the system is.
Nobody, and then it just
circulates.
Vicious cycle.
It's vicious cycle.
And not a lot make it out. You know,
no,
like
not a lot.
Lucas Radebe.
Very, very few makes it out. Mm. For the fact that you still speak about Lucas Radebe right now, it tells you that he made it out very early on.
Yes.
Not many guys, you cannot mention many.
Yeah.
And now we as South Africans, we enjoy the stories of, but look at where he is right now. This is a guy that I used to watch. He used to do this in the field of play, but look at what he drives, look at what, you know, those type of things. We're looking at the negative side of it, but you don't understand the cause of that as well. Because when you're a footballer playing for a big team, it's automatically assumed that you're earning a lot of money.
Mm.
But what is a lot of money? A lot of money is a relative.
Yeah.
your lot of money might not be a lot of money to me.
Yeah, true.
You understand?
True.
Your 60 grand might be a lot of money to you, but not to me.
Yeah.
Because I've got so many debts. I'm paying this car, I'm paying this. I've got maybe 3-4 houses to feed.
Yeah.
So it becomes different from every person to person. So whenever you're playing for such big teams, you automatically assume that you're earning a lot of money.
Yeah.
And not every contract is the same.
Black tax.
And I promise you, in South Africa, if we get to a culture where contracts are open, everybody knows how much everybody owns, earns, I promise you there's a lot of players that will start earning better money.
Yeah, Mom Kiza does that.
She's open about it.
Yeah, she plays the players with an envelope on the
yeah, on the pitch.
On the pitch.
Yeah. No mistake about.
Me? She doesn't know mistakes.
No, let me tell you. I saw that happening. It wasn't a good look for football in South Africa. Yes. Owners do pay players bonuses and all that type
for
of
sure.
stuff. Depending on the game, how excited you are.
Yeah.
I had a conversation actually with Andile Mpisan the other day. And we spoke about it. And then I actually remember saying that I understand what you guys are doing, but also you need to understand the pressure that you guys are, the pressure that you guys are bringing into the team, right? The lot of eyes that you bring into the team, and those are not positive eyes.
Yeah.
You know, no,
so
yeah.
Side chicks are calling, hey, I saw you.
Bruh, like, you have money.
Yeah.
And you're putting these boys in an awkward position.
Yeah.
You gave me hard cash. Now I know that he's got money. I'm waiting for him to come back from the game. So you and you know what's happening right now in our country.
I know he lives.
Yeah, you know. So we're putting these boys in under a difficult situation. And I think those are the things that we don't really want to see in the league. We love what they're doing with the club, the hype that they're bringing. It's something new, something fresh. It keeps the league exciting. I love what is happening, but I just hope that those personal things can be done very privately. So,
yeah. What's the most expensive thing you bought for yourself? Not the Aston Martin.
Not for myself. There's a lot, bro.
Is it?
Yeah, there's a lot. There's a lot. I don't remember.
Was it a watch?
I remember. I think. Let me put it this way: the most ridiculous thing that I bought that I didn't want, it was a watch.
Yeah.
I think when we're playing Champions League, we went somewhere the airport somewhere. Yeah. I think I bought a watch. It was 16 grand. And I bought the watch because I was expected to buy something. You know when you walk into a store, they're like, I don't know how to buy something. I'm like, fuck me.
Yeah, yeah.
Trust me, I didn't even enjoy that watch.
Yeah.
And I don't wear watches. I'm not a guy that wears watches.
Yeah.
So it's like in a restaurant, you have to tip. You're deco.
Yeah, you're deco. You have to tip. Look, dude, like I remember going out so many times with the footballers. We'll go to a club and all that type of stuff. Every time we get there, we eat. When the bill comes, it's written my name.
Yeah.
Everywhere I go, when the bill comes, it's written my name. So I'm forced to pay.
Yeah.
So a lot of guys that they know themselves, when we went to the groove, they'll hide when the bill comes.
Yeah.
Those motherfuckers. They'll hide when the bill comes. So I remember that. So
and you don't want no attention, you're just gonna swipe.
Yeah, because I don't want attention. I remember remember when Zah was Zah.
Yes. I sent it.
Zah, nice, beautiful chicks.
Hey.
First time I knew that they were fake boobs, so it did Zah. Everything there was nice. So now the bill came and the guys disappeared. And then the bill was 16 grand at the time. Right? And with the 16 grand, most of the stuff that were on the bill, some things that I don't even drink.
Yeah.
Bro. And I'm expecting us to split.
Yeah.
Right? Nobody. People ran away. You know, I realized when I was in Cape Town that actually splitting the bill is a norm.
Yeah. Amongst white people. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Because in Joburg, if you're a dick-o-medi, you're expecting to pay.
Yeah.
So when I got to Cape Town, I was like, I'm trying to pay. But like, no, bro.
No, we're splitting.
But the bill is 300. So
no,
what?
No,
but we're splitting. I'm like, and I remember saying the fuck, I wish I knew this thing when I was still in Joburg. So it was one
it's
of
a white thing. That's how they keep the money.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Yeah. Tell me about the. You met a Sangoma in Congo.
Yeah.
Yeah, what was going on there?
Look, there's a guy. I was chilling in. At Vilagas in Soweto, you know?
Yeah.
I'm chilling there. There's a guy, I think he was one of the ANC members that we all know in the hood. He comes there, he said, me bra, you need to meet this guy. This guy promised me money if I bring you to him.
Okay.
And then he, what he said was that this guy is into business and into mines and all that type of stuff. And I'm like, oh, fuck. Finally, somebody wants to give me an opportunity. Because when you're a footballer, everybody thinks you're dumb.
Yes, you don't know anything. Yeah.
So I was like, okay, cool. Let me go meet this guy. So this guy stays in Bryanston. We meet there the first day. So I'm seeing business people coming in and out with Johnny Walker Blue, all the type of stuff.
Which one is this?
And I'm like, this guy
is
the one. No?
Yeah.
So we're playing pool, we're still trying to know each other, we're playing pool, you're having a great shot nyan in the pool, he gives you $2,000. And I'm like, this guy's money, right? So he brings me to his room. His room is like full of Louis Vuitton suitcases. US dollars, bruh, in those bags. Pop, 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 pop. I'm like, yo, yeah, I know this guy's got money. I need to stick with this guy.
Mm.
So this guy's like, Mamela, dude, I just wanted to meet you. You know, there's something that I need to do for you. I like you. I remember those days when you're still playing for Orlando Pirates, blah, 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 blah. I'm like, okay, cool. Then he told me to come back, I think, the other week. So I'm going back there with so much excitement, you know? I'm thinking, okay, finally we'll discuss exactly what is it that he called me for. Then we get there, but there's one thing that is weird that I realized. In his house, there's no female. There's only guys.
It's niggas. Mm.
It's his niggas there, and then they're cooking for him and all that. When they bring food to him, they all kneel down. So it was kind of weird for me if he's a businessman. What kind of businessman that you need to kneel when you give him food?
Looks like a cult.
Yeah. So he started explaining to me that he's the king of kings in the continent. No, in the continent. You know there's kings, right?
Yeah.
And then within those kings, there is somebody that leads them.
Oh, shit, I didn't know that. Oh.
You know?
Yeah.
So he's the king, and then with all other kings.
Yeah.
So when he comes to the country, he probably goes to maybe to speak to King Mujaji or whatever, King Zuliti,
all other
kings.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's the main guy.
He's the main guy.
That's how he introduced himself to me. So now he's telling me that, hey, look, I've got a gift. I was sent to you to actually try and help you. And I'm like, here we fucking go again.
Mm.
And then he said to me, so many bad things are gonna happen to you. So we need to protect you, we need to do this, we need to do that. And then he gave me a rabbit. But the way that he gave me a rabbit was so fucking scary. He brought me in the room, a very, very dark room, right? You see this these things that you see in the market, those ones that are done with the hood. The sculptures.
Yes, the sculptures, yes.
The sculptures, yes. Yeah. So there was a lot of sculptures in the room. Bruh, I swear to God. He said to me, close your eyes. If you open your eyes, you wish you never opened your eyes.
Sure.
So I fucking closed my eyes. And you know when somebody says don't do it, like I feel like I need to just take a little pic.
Yes.
There was two of us. I never said a word. He was speaking in his tongue things were responding to him.
Yo!
Like, but it's a weird voice. It's not a human voice.
No way!
They were responding to him. I swear to God. Those things were responding to him, right? Then once he was done, it took like 15 minutes. Once he was done, and then he said, because there's candles around. And then he said, I should put my hand inside like a shoebox.
Yeah.
Put my hand in there. Blah, 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 whatever he said. Brought up my hand. He closed it, whatever. Came out a rabbit. Then he said, this is something that's going to protect you and guide you. You need to take care of this, right? And you can't buy carrots at Woolies or whatever the place might be. You need to come back here. There's always going to be a person in this house that will give you those, right?
Yeah.
And with that, because all these things, you need to pay money.
Yeah.
You need to pay $50,000, right? I remember going to the bank and withdrawing $50,000. My friend was pissed.
Dog.
He was so pissed at me. I'm like, bruh, you know I need money.
Sure.
And I'm like, and I'm busy encouraging him, like, we're gonna be nice. Don't worry, man, we're gonna be good. So that $50,000, I needed to change it into dollars.
Mm.
Take that money, give that guy. That motherfucker put it in a pot, pour something there.
He lit it?
Yeah.
Whoa.
And the money was gone. No ash, no nothing. The money was gone. And then...
What do you mean, bro?
Bruh, yo, guys, there's a lot of things happening out there. Just disappeared. And then it went on for... I just paid once.
Mm.
But the visitation went on for like maybe two more times. And then my conscience came back. You know, it was like, hey, bro, what are you doing?
Mm.
You know, and then I stopped seeing him. And at the time, nothing bad was happening to me.
Yeah.
It's not like, then nothing. Like, I felt nothing. And I started continuing with my life.
Yeah.
And then years later, when I bump into this guy in Sandton with his family, he just said hi, and I said hi. And then I said to my wife, you remember the guy that I wrote about in a book? There he is. He didn't even look me in the eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure he read about it, because he was one of those guys that who actually FaceTimed me while in Dubai. He made me believe that he's the guy. He was a facade.
He was a scam.
Yeah, whether he's a king or not, whether he is what he is or not, but it's just that what was happening at the time, it was for the second time it happens. I remember getting a call from a mysterious number, a private number, all the time. Yeah, now we're in the kitchen right now.
Hey, my dog.
So I remember getting a call for 2 years straight that would tell me what to do, where to go, where not to go, right? And that same call, the same woman that was on my call every day will tell me, go to a such and such street, this address, check your emails. When I look at my emails, you need to print those. So I printed all those emails out, those forms out. They were Freemason forms. So I needed to join the cult.
Freemason.
Yeah, I needed to join them. I was directed to, I was even told that we were in black. We meet every Tuesdays and Thursdays, 12 midnight. I was told all the things. Yeah. So niggas will have been looking for my soul for the longest time.
Who's the rabbit now? What happened to the rabbit?
Yeah,
I think it disappeared. I don't know why. I don't know what happened. It disappeared in the house.
But you kept it in the house.
It just disappeared.
No, because in the garage. So put there in the garage. It disappeared. I didn't know where it went. And I think from it disappearing, then I stopped calling that guy. I blocked him all the time. Then I started living my life. That was it. That's how I lost contact with him.
But you remember those voices? For me, that's the craziest part.
Yeah, it was very scary. And you're doing all these things, you're naked, bro. You're naked, and then they're fucked up. They put those white cloth and red ones, they put it on your shoulder. They say, look the other way. And then they start all doing all these things. For me, I was scared.
Yeah.
And that's when I start questioning myself. Why these people keep coming to you, and why are you falling for this shit?
Yeah.
You know, why keep falling for this bullshit? And I think, lucky me, you know, I was able to escape that, because I can imagine, because a lot of souls have been taken like that.
Bro,
way,
you imagine know? You have nothing.
Yeah, of course. And
at least you have something to fall back on, you
yeah,
know?
So fortunate for me, I was able to escape that twice. This was the second
Jesus,
time,
bro.
Twice. So I knew, after that, I know, even today, I know that, you know, they're still out there trying to get my soul. For what? What they're trying to use it for? And to be honest with you, most people don't believe these things exist because they never happened to you.
Yeah.
Don't dismiss it.
Damn, dog.
Because maybe you're not their target.
Yeah.
You know? Hockey club.
It so kills me. He says that guy was making up the sounds.
Yeah, I'm saying, yeah, in that room when he said, don't open your eyes.
Yeah.
Maybe it's him. Maybe it's like a ventriloquist and he changed his voice. Because,
that's
I mean, if he's a scammer,
that's
then all that issue's not real. And that's enough.
But if you walked into that room,
you'd believe.
If you walked into that room.
Of course, he's dressed to seem mystical.
Bruh, in that room, nobody goes in there but him. You look at the setup, it's all guys, they worship him. They worship him.
It's all an act.
Oh, I get crazy. That.
They've all been paid.
Maybe.
Man.
Maybe.
That stuff scares me, dog. Hey, it scares
Trust me.
Bro.
You know that it's true, right? That you find those guys that have got so much money, but there's that one room in the house. It's always locked.
Oh, we've heard of those stories where they keep their thing.
Yeah, the snake.
It exists. Somebody had, they always need to have something.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And in that case, for me, it was a rabbit. And I'm definitely sure that it was going to progress to something else.
Yeah.
They probably really start with you. Yeah. You know, entry level, but Akia rabbit from the rabbit, what else? And by then, your soul already has been taken. So now you're under their spell.
Hey, shout out, man. It's a good thing you didn't fall for it, though.
Bruh. Like, it was very dangerous.
On a light note, we're going to play a game.
True.
It's called One Must Go, ne? So I'm going to give you two things. You must tell me which one must go.
Am I going to train with this shit?
Nah, never. I think you would have trended already. We've done like 2 hours.
Yeah.
All right, cool. La Liga, EPL. Which one must go?
I think La Liga.
Yeah.
La Liga must go.
Yeah.
When Messi bounced there, Ronaldo bounced.
Yo, no, bro, it wasn't the same. It's not 10 years ago, it was lit.
It was lit, yeah. So it's, I don't think Spain are the leading nation in terms of football right now. Mm. And you can see the struggle in the national team as well. You can see the struggle in the league as well. So I think EPL now went back to being the number one. And I think, yeah, EPL is the one.
I thought you'd choose La Liga because they're more technical.
They are.
You're a technical player.
Yeah, they are. That's what I love about La Liga. But as well, is you see EPL, there's a lot of technical players that are moving across to come to the EPL.
Yes.
EPL is very competitive. And like, unlike your
Pep and Klopp. Oh, yes.
Now there's a lot of technical players as well. There's a lot of good teams. No longer about Manchester United anymore. Mm. There's Manchester City. Mm, Liverpool is back now again. Mm. You know, there's a lot. Okay, Arsenal are struggling, but still, there's a lot of clubs that are doing very well, and there's a lot of good players that are coming into the EPL. EPL before, it was a lot of trucks, long throws, let's hit. Now there's a lot of technical players that are coming there. So the EPL, I think, if you regard it as a great player, you need to be playing in that league.
Favorite team in the EPL?
I'm a Pep Guardiola fan.
Yeah.
So if Pep can move to Barca tomorrow,
I'll
start tomorrow. I'm a Pep
wherever
fan.
Wherever he goes.
Yeah, I'm a Pep fan because of his philosophies. Yeah, I can relate so much to him. Yeah. So I strongly support Man City.
And then La Liga?
La Liga, I was a Barcelona fan.
Barcelona.
For the longest time.
Yeah. Okay, cool. One must go. Pizzo, Benny McCarthy.
Yeah, I think I'll say Benny McCarthy because I worked for so many years with Pizzo and I've won so many trophies with him.
Yeah.
And I think it's one coach that actually understood the kind of person that I am.
Yeah.
And even though Benny, I won a trophy that I didn't win at Sundowns, but I'll forever be grateful for that. But I'll just say because of, you know, the longevity that I work with Pizzo.
How amazing is Pizzo, bro? Like what he's doing in Egypt is amazing.
No, Pizzo,
right?
No, let me tell you this. Pizzo is an amazing coach. Pizzo is, when you have conversation with Pizzo, it's football. And he loves football so much that it's crazy sometimes, and it's so demanding as well. And the kind of work that he puts in, you know, for me, it's not a surprise where he is. You know, it was destined for that to happen at some point. And look, and I think he's now an inspiration for so many coaches, especially black coaches in the country. Because now he's tapping into foreign markets and foreign places where normally a South African coach only wants to coach. You know, so he's opening so many doors for them. So it's crazy what he's doing. And I'm sure that he's not even done yet.
Yeah, bro, he must go to Man United, man. He's way better than Ollie, I'm sure. I know he's better than Ollie.
Better job. Talk to him.
Everybody's better than Ollie.
Yeah. Sundowns, Pirates. 1 month ago.
Pirates. No, one must go, right? I won every trophy that everybody said I wouldn't win.
Yes.
At Sundowns.
Okay.
Right? And everybody knew me, or everybody started knowing what Teko Modisa was because of Pirates.
Yes.
Right? So if it wasn't for Pirates, Sundowns wouldn't happen at the time, right? But I think
Pirates must go
merely because I got so much success at Sundowns.
And they made you bath in black water. So. And nothing after that.
I won Football of the Year twice with the London Pirates.
Well, but trophies.
No, trophies, none.
Yeah,
I've got silver medals from there.
Isn't it crazy how after you left the teams, they would win?
Bro, the same season that I left the team, Pirates won treble.
Yeah.
And I remember in the media, instead of them celebrating Orlando Pirates winning treble, they're like, the reason why you guys won, because that guy's no longer there.
Yo, bro, how crazy.
Fucked me up mentally for such a long time.
Sure, I can imagine, dog. So, yeah. Themba Zwane versus Dr. Kumalo. One must go.
No, Mdogis.
Doctor?
Yeah.
Doctor must go.
Yeah. Look, I'll tell you this. Doctor paved the way for us, for people like us, to understand what is a brand, to become a brand as
for
a football player.
For sure.
You know, Doctor is the guy.
Yeah.
Yes.
Doctor made football fashionable. He made it stylish. He made us want to play the game itself. What Themba Zwane is doing right now, it's amazing in itself. And I think he's set the trend, he's set the mark, the benchmark in the PSL, that he's still dominating as a player. And it's very difficult to dominate for such a long time.
Yeah, longevity.
Yes, and I think Mshishi's been doing this for almost 4 years or 5 years, dominant, playing the way that he does. And it's not easy. And I know the struggles that comes with that dominance. So with Temba Zwane, I can relate more. But Doctor, I watched him play. With Temba Zwane, I played with him. So for me to see him what he is today, it's an amazing feeling. So that's why I'm saying Doctor must go.
Bro, did you ever watch Doctor play? I never watched him, eh?
I've seen Doctor. I mean, I remember my best memory is that Brazil game.
I think that was the best game. No, it was one of the best.
One of his best games
in the national team.
Yes.
He took Brazil and put it in his pocket.
Literally.
Like, that's how Doctor was.
Brazil.
And my mom went to school with Doctor. Eh?
Really?
Mm. For real?
Mm.
Hey.
Wow.
I think they kissed or something in the toilet.
I'm sure. Definitely sure. Doctor was famous very early on.
Who's the modern day Doctor? Because I never watched him, but I hear so much about him.
It'll be a disrespect to Doctor.
It's like Ronaldinho?
No. If I had to compare anybody with Doctor Komal, it's a disrespect. I don't care what anybody says.
Yeah.
What Doctor has done, nobody's ever done it. Mm. Right? And I think with there's players that might say, okay, this player was good in this era. This one was good in this era. Doctor was just good, period.
Sure.
You understand what I'm saying? And I know some might disagree with what I'm saying, but for me, you know, as a person that played the game, I think Doctor is for me, it's one of the best players that I've watched in the
country. Give me your top five best players ever.
In the country?
Yeah, in the country, yeah.
I would say that I've watched play.
100%.
Because the best player ever is Jomo Sono. So,
sure, yeah.
But I would say Doctor, Shoes Mushweu.
Shoes.
I would say Papi Zotwani.
Hmm.
I would say that's three. I would say Benedict Vilakazi.
Oh, so.
Hey, so.
Yeah. I would say Jabu.
It's a crazy list, eh?
Yeah, because the thing is, like, there's a lot of great players that I've watched play.
Yeah.
But there's very few players that changed the game.
Mm.
You know, that impacted the game the way they did.
Oh, yes.
Jabu impacted the game so much that teams actually started believing that youngsters can actually do it.
Oh, yeah.
Jabu came with funny hairstyles and he was always AWOL, but when put him on the pitch, Jabu was different.
Yeah.
And then you speak of Papi Zotwani was the guy that was playing in the same position within the national team. He was way better than me.
Hmm.
And then I had to wait for my opportunity, for a chance to play.
Yeah.
And he was one of those guys that I enjoyed watching him play. Of course, he never got
the recognition
that he deserved.
Yeah.
But for me, it's one of those players. And who did I say again? Vilakazi.
Mm.
So Vilakazi, I used to watch him play when I was still in Diepkloof. We'll walk to the ground and watch So play. And the same thing that he was doing in the hood, he was doing in the PSL.
Wow.
And it was great for me to see. I think he's one of those guys as well that gave us hope, got Diepkloof, that if So can actually make it, can open doors for us, it's possible for us to actually be
but
there.
But he lied about his age though. So.
I don't know. Leave too alone.
Legend, dog.
Yeah.
Last one, Messi, Ronaldo. One must go.
Ronaldo must go.
Ronaldo.
Okay. Here's the thing. I'm speaking from a football point of view.
Yeah.
Ronaldo made it possible for those guys that didn't have much potential to believe that hard work can actually make them succeed.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yes.
He's not a natural.
Yes.
Yes. Messi's a fucking alien, bro.
Yes.
What
I
Messi
agree.
Does, you no can't, other player
you
can do it.
You can practice 1,000 years.
You can't learn.
Exactly.
Can't,
so that's why it's so difficult for people to relate to Messi than Ronaldo, because Ronaldo is relatable because it's what we go through.
Yeah.
I need to work hard. You can take what Ronaldo goes through to put in your personal life.
So what you're saying is you can train, work hard, you can be like Ronaldo.
You can be.
Mario, you can't be like Messi.
No, nobody can. No matter what you do, you can't. It's you that gifted or not.
Yeah.
You know, and Messi is gifted in that sense. But I can tell you one thing. Ronaldo shows us, he takes off his shirt, blah, 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 whatever the case. We can see that Ronaldo trains, take care of himself. You cannot tell me Messi can score a 40-meter free kick if he's not training as hard as Ronaldo.
Oh, yeah.
But he doesn't show it.
Yes.
Messi is not the type. They've got two different personalities. Ronaldo is famous on Instagram because he's doing all the stuff. He's inspiration to so many
players. He's a brand, yeah.
He's a brand. Messi is not a brand. All Messi does, he wants to play the game.
That's it. Kind of like you.
But he's got the money, though, to back him up.
Mm.
And it's just one of those situations where Messi will be... highly appreciated once he's gone.
100%.
Once he no longer plays the game, that's when he'll be highly appreciated because of what he does to the game. Messi changed the game. Ronaldo inspired the game, but Messi changed the fucking game itself.
I like that. What do you think about the state of soccer in SA right now?
It's I think it's still the same.
Yeah.
We haven't grown as much.
Yeah.
Or maybe we're not moving as much as I thought that we should, because we're one of the best leagues in the continent, and but also in the other side is there's a lot of teams in the country that are now starting getting exposed in the African continent of football, which means there are something great that we do, but I think there's a lot of room to improve, and hopefully we'll see ex-footballers, people that play the game, being in positions of football
at the high level
because gotcha. People that are in the high level, they most of them are politicians, most of them are people that never play the game, so they can't relate to anybody that plays the game. So that's why sometimes we have a shortage of certain things, because people that are there, they don't have the emotional intelligence of somebody that play the game itself. So I just wish, because if we need to copy the best, you look at all the best countries football wise they have people that play the game in those positions.
Yeah,
you look at
Germany.
You look at South Africa, we don't have.
Yeah, no,
we should be speaking like this, having Lucas Radebe somewhere in that position.
100%.
Dr. Khumalo in certain positions where it matters most.
Making
and we
decisions,
don't have.
Yeah,
exactly. So we don't have.
Tell me about your tattoos, bro.
My tattoos are pop, my bro.
You don't like them?
Look, when I started doing tattoos, I think it was the influence of music, rap.
Oh, yeah.
And early on in my career, I don't think at the time there were footballers in the country, full sleeves and all that type of stuff. But for me, I was in so much pain. Tattoos also were part of my, maybe something that helped me deal with the pain that I was going through.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, so every tattoo actually was because of something that I was going through at the time.
Yeah, that's hectic, bro.
Yeah, like...
So it was like therapy?
Yeah, basically. So like I fucking have maybe a bad month, and I'm like, fuck it, I need a tattoo.
Sure.
And I'll do a tattoo, and I'll come
back
again.
This one, which one is this one?
I think the hands, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's one of those tattoos that I never thought that I never wanted to have a tattoo on my neck or anywhere else that is exposed, in a sense of once I'm retired, if I have to wear a suit, then my tattoo corporate or all that type of stuff. But it's just that it's one of those things where you're like, at that time you're feeling a certain way. My tattoos right now, I can't explain them, because at the time I was feeling a certain way about them, and this is what I wanted, you know. Like for instance, this right now, maybe a couple of years ago, people thought it was, I think that's the monogram for Louis Vuitton or whatever the case is. And it's not. For me, it resembles a brick wall that I had to go through.
Sure.
You know, it's a brick wall that every time I had to go through things, it's just this wall.
Yeah.
You know, so at the time I was feeling something that would, and I'll think about it, and I'll try and have a tattoo that actually explains how I felt.
There's a word or name, this. What does it say on your right arm? Lift.
My reason. Here's the thing. You remember I said the voice that used to call me all the time?
Yeah.
For 2 years, that tells me what to do and what not to do. That person, I actually thought it was an angel sent to me, because I was at the lowest of the lowest. I was getting guideship from the person that I don't even know. And stupidly enough, I tattooed the name of the person.
Yeah.
What's the name?
Marissa.
Marissa.
She was called that.
Sure. And then you got another name here, ne? On this one.
Where?
Yeah. No, oh, that's Mudisi.
That's Mudisi, yeah.
Damn, dog. Hey, but tattoos just look cool, bro.
But now, lately became a fashion statement. But back then, but if you look at it, for me, I'll say, if you have to compare my game to basketball, I think Iverson.
Yeah.
I think Iverson described my game so much, because Iverson came into the basketball world. It changed how basketball looks. Remember basketball, they used to wear suits and
he
came there with a headband, you know, straight bags, tattoos.
Yes.
He started dressing like a rapper itself.
Yes.
So it changed the look and feel of the basketball team. Basketball in that sense. For me, in the PSL, I think I changed how footballers, not necessarily I changed how footballers dress, but I influenced how they dress. Mm. I influenced the tattoo side of things, the hairstyle side of things,
yes. You're right.
You know, all the type of stuff. So there was a lot of, but back then I didn't know, because I was doing these things because I loved them. Because I loved rap so much.
And you're expressing yourself.
I was expressing myself, because it gave me that in rap, people are expressing themselves. So how can I best express myself in the field that I'm in? Then, not necessarily that I started dressing like rappers, but it just that the influence of music itself, it shaped how I moved as well. So I started having tattoos. You forever see me with shades.
Yeah.
I hardly have a picture with no shades on. You forever see me with shades, because they're part of my personality right now. At first it was a fashion statement thing, but just now it's part of my personality type of thing. So I got influence from basketball and music itself.
Did you ever get fined in training?
Fine, yeah. A lot of times.
For real? What?
I've been fined a lot of times. Look, I remember the first fine that I got was because my car had a sound system that was so loud that Pizza fined me. He called it Tiko Modise fine. Because we're training in the campus, right? And he says, he was saying that I was disturbing students in the class.
Yeah.
So after training, I can put a hip-hop song up. So he was like, you think I'm disaffected. If somebody plays music so loud, they'll get fined. So that was the first fine that I actually got. And then the second fine that I got from him as well was the second bookable offense that I got. And it was a red card, I think 2 minutes before the game end. And the next game, we had an important game. So I was fined for getting a red card. What else was I fined for? I remember being fined for wearing Nike socks at Atlanta Pirates. I remember being fined for putting a jersey on my shoulder. Not a jersey, but a jacket over my shoulder at Atlanta Pirates.
Mm.
I've been fined for so many things.
Yo, that's crazy, dog.
I've been fined. But I've never been suspended.
Yeah. What are you asking, sir?
Who's your rap coach?
In the country.
No, yeah. Your rap coach, Jay.
Period.
Yeah.
I think it's Jiga, man.
I think Jiga.
I think he the older he gets, his music matures.
Yeah.
And I think not many can relate right now with what he speaks about.
But the thing is, I would
like to believe that whoever that sings, especially in the rap game, you speak about what exists in your circle and exists within you, right? And Jiga now is a billionaire.
So
his conversations are different.
And you can relate.
So you understand? Because he's one guy that every rapper wants to be like. Yeah. So he knows his status. So he's not looking for any validation somewhere 100%. Else. You know? So for me, that confidence, and if you can go to Reasonable Doubt, he knew exactly what he was.
Mm. First
back
album,
then.
Yes.
You know, so others can say Lil Wayne was saying he's the best rapper alive back then, before he was even regarded as one. So for me, there was a lot of things that I took from hip hop that actually helped me to become the better player that I was, because that arrogancy that I want to be the best,
and you know,
I took it there from listening to hip hop. I was like, if these guys are so confident about them, you know, they're projecting it to the universe, and that's why even today I can actually come here and sit and tell you that in my generation, I strongly believe that I was the best.
I strongly believe
that I was the best, and I might be wrong.
Yeah,
I might be wrong,
but
that's what I believe, because of what I've done. Not forget about all the trophies that I've won, but I've won every individual award that needs to be won in the country. Before, when I joined the PSL, there was no Football of the Year. There was no such a trophy. Football of the Year. I was the first one to win it, and I won it twice in a row. Mm. When I was in NFD, there was no such thing as a Football of the Year. Mm. I won it in NFD, and then when I think the most precious award for me that I've won, and it was the Sports Personality of the Year, because the first time I got nominated for, I was competing against Habana, and he just won the World Cup.
There was no way I was going to win against that guy.
The second time around, and I won it. It was one of those fulfilling moments, because now you're not only competing with your peers, you're competing with everybody that's in the sports
in
the country.
Yeah.
So winning that, for me, that's why I'm saying that if you take all the trophies that I won with any club, now you're judging me individually as Tiko Modise, right? Take away all those trophies. If you have to judge me, nobody has won all the trophies that I won.
The men of the matches, they stopped even giving you because you're winning too many.
At Orlando Pirates, they were the player of the month. They stopped that. At Mamelodi Sundowns, when I got there, also there were awards for Player of the Month. They actually stopped that. But but those for clubs, they didn't mean much for me because I'm just competing with my teammates.
Yeah.
But what were the ones that meant more was me competing with everybody that was in the PSL, your footballer awards, your midfielder of the year.
Yeah.
So you're competing with other guys as well. So those were trophies that really meant a lot to me because I feel like, you know, there were some kind of appreciation of what I was doing.
100%.
And I really, really enjoyed winning all those awards. But it was never enough. I wanted to win football of the year. I think when I was Sports Personality of the Year, I think I was supposed to win football of the year that time. Because I can't be Sports Personality of the Year and not win football.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Exactly.
Because you're a footballer.
Yeah, but I had two already. So if you have three, it becomes a lot. It becomes too much. It must come down a little bit. And I strongly believe that if your Messi's, your Ronaldo's were in this country, they wouldn't get 4-6 Ballon d'Ors. Yeah. It becomes
too
much.
That's stupid.
You know? So
hip hop in SA?
In SA?
Mm. Who do you fucks with?
Dead or alive.
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 Let's do alive.
I'll give you my five. Alive.
Okay.
Not in any particular order.
Sure.
I think KO.
Poof.
I think KO can jump in any beat
so
and
consistent.
Be himself.
So
very consistent as well. And I think I love Stooge T because he raps.
Mara, KO can't get stuck.
No, KO can get stuck. Don't say it. Yes, yeah, KO can get stuck. No. I think he was fucking with me at the time. I think I love Stooge because he raps.
Yeah, he really raps.
I love Kulichana as well.
Yeah.
I just wish he can come back and really, really rap.
Yo, bro.
You know? And that's three. Who else?
None of these new cats.
No. Not that they're bad though, but I'm starting to listen to Blackie as well.
Blackie, yeah. It's fine.
I think it's nice.
Fire,
it's fine. Nasty because of where he is,
yeah,
and how young he is, and I think also he opened so many doors for this young.
Yeah, he's changing the game.
He's changing the game.
Yeah.
And last one. Hey, alive, there's not so many. But dead, I mean, pro,
nah.
Jabba.
No, Casper, no AK, bro.
Bring back my ish.
Look. Don't put me in there. Look, I love AK. I love Casper. I think AK, there was this point in time when he was untouchable.
Yeah.
It was every album was fire, you know, and I think everybody's got an era or everybody's got a period of time
of course,
as well.
It's
and you need to go a little bit of a dip and be able to come back. And I think once he comes back and then he becomes a part of the conversation, but he's always been a dope artist for me.
Sure.
I think Keenan spoke about being at the best at the time when he had one single out.
Yeah.
I remember doing a shoot with him. I didn't know who he was.
Mm.
You know, and he was speaking about being the best. I'm like, who's this kid?
Yeah.
Not that I'm disrespecting him. And I remember Tib saying that it's AK. I'm like, oh, because I didn't know the face.
Exactly.
But he was speaking about how great he was back then, even with one single at the time. So with Casper as well is, look, I don't want to get into this debate of Casper and AKA.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't want to start training that maybe Casper now thinks that I don't like him or AKA doesn't. But I feel like...
And it's very emotional, eh?
I didn't say that. But I think both guys are great at what they do. Their beef actually, I think it excited the hip hop.
It did.
The hip hop scene as
escalated
well.
Escalated them as well.
Yeah. I think
it was needed.
Of course. And I think they're doing great music irrespective. But for me, it's just that when I speak hip hop, I speak about people that raps.
Mm.
Yeah. People that actually rap. Yeah, like
Aries, you don't rate Aries.
I actually do listen to Aries, but the thing is, bruh, I'm saying if Aries can reach the mainstream that everybody that we spoke about, then Aries will be a different Aries that we're speaking about. And I think with whatever that he's doing that he's comfortable in, I just wish one day, you know, he can break through and become what he's supposed to be, because he's so dope. But it's like, but he's dope, but where, Aries? Can you come this side? Can you please come to the mainstream? Can you please be this guy?
Step into your light.
Step into the light, because you've got so much to give. And I feel like he's comfortable with what he does, because he wants
course.
To own.
Yeah.
You know, this rappers and all that type of stuff, whatever they're going through. But I feel like when it comes to raps, and especially with the age, I think Aries can stand his own. Yeah, can rap.
All right. Teko. thank you so much for coming, man. This has been fucking amazing.
Thank
bro.
You very much. Finally, I'm here.
Finally, eh? Well, it's only been a year. There's some people have been making me wait for 2 years, so it's fine.
Yeah, no, but every time your podcast comes out, I'll get tagged there.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, to come here and actually speak to you guys. So there was a lot of pressure.
No, but I'm glad you came now because you're in a different space, you know?
Yeah, I am.
And I love where you're at.
I am. And I think also for me, it was important as well to come here being in a different space as well. You know, to be able to project myself properly as well so that you can understand and hear what I'm saying without being emotional as well. Sometimes you need to be very careful of what we say.
100%.
You know, and irrespective of you telling your story or not, but you need to be careful of what you say because your story, because somebody else did something. Your experiences as well, you become experienced because of what you went through as well. So what I went through, there's a lot of people were involved, but I'm very grateful for my experience. But I know that most people played their part, whether it was good or bad. So, but I need to be able to be very smart and be careful about it and how to put it, because at the end of the day, I don't want to be here and be bashing people and saying this one was bad, this one was, because I also played a part in that as well. So I need to take responsibility and accountability for that.
Are we getting a second book? Because there's so much you left out in the first one, bro.
I think I'll get the second book.
Nice.
I think it's important to do that, maybe with the progression of where I am today.
Yeah.
And here's the thing that I nearly forgot. There was questions as to why leaving Sundowns to go to Cape Town City. Right? At Sundowns, you're there.
Yeah, 100%.
Right?
Rocking.
Yes, and Cape Town City is there. That move affected me. It affected my bottom line. Right? But the experience that I got from Cape Town City, I feel like if I didn't get that experience in Cape Town, I wouldn't be where I am today.
Ooh,
I needed to go there.
I get you.
I got there. I found myself.
And you can't put money to that.
You can't put money to
any,
that. And
any.
I needed to escape.
Yeah.
Because there was a lot of toxic in Joburg. A lot of stuff happening around me. And I've been in that circle for such a long time.
Yeah.
And I knew that if I had to retire feeling this way, I'm going to hate the game.
Yes, bro.
So I don't want to hate the game. Let me go somewhere else where it's very peaceful, where it's very calm. And Cape Town.
You found Benny.
I found Benny. And I found calm. And I found myself there. And when I came back to Joburg, I was a different person.
You
asking me now, I'm staying in Pretoria East.
Yeah,
you're expecting me to stay in Joburg.
Exactly.
I want peace and quiet because I'm so used to the Cape Town lifestyle.
It's nice, that side, dog.
Fucking nice, bro.
Yo, nobody knows you. You can feel the breeze. You can hear the birds.
Nah, you can go anywhere you want. But I'm very grateful for that experience. And I think actually that helped me. So in my probably maybe second book, are those type of chances that people need to take with themselves.
Yeah.
Because as a footballer, you're so scared to take chances because you're not sure of how talented you are. We're taking our talents and give it to our agents.
Yeah.
For agents to control it, to tell us where to go. So we're so insecure about our talents. We're thinking we're not good enough until somebody else tells us.
And the agent's just seeing money.
Yeah, and the agent only shows up when he has to sign a contract and he bounces. Yeah. So also I'm trying to get into that space as well and to actually give the power back to the players, being the ones that are in charge of their careers and showing them ropes and teaching them on how to do so. Because signing a contract is easy, but knowing what's in the contract is a difficult thing. And I think we sign contract because we're so scared that this opportunity might not come again, only to bind ourselves or to imprison us with these contracts that really don't make sense. Other people are making money over, so become slaves in the game. So you become a slave, and then once they're done with you, they spit you out, and then the next person comes. So that's why we're saying most of South African footballers don't make it. Because like I said earlier, the system is designed for us to fail, because nobody in South Africa can play in South Africa for over 20 years and be able to make so much money to survive after retirement.
Nope.
You can't.
You can't name me one.
Exactly. Yeah. So the system itself, it's wrong.
Yeah.
If that's the case, because not everybody wants to go into coaching. Nobody wants to. Not everybody, because once you retire, because once you come to coaching, you go back to the same schedule that you had as a player. You're going to camps, waking up at 8, you're coming back home at 5.
So you're not coaching, man?
No, I don't want to coach because I don't want to get back to that schedule because I hated camps where you have to eat at a certain time. No. So I'm getting into that space to actually try and make sure that all these the upcoming ones, I need to understand that they are the ones who are doing the job.
Yeah.
The other people besides them, they're working for them, not the other way around. Because I believe that I was working for my agent, not understanding that my agent actually was working for me. I was his boss. So I need to make this place understand that you're the boss, they're not their bosses. Yeah.
You know? Deku, thank you so much for coming through, man.
Thank you very much for having
me. In closing, what do you want to be remembered as, bro?
I want to be remembered as a person that loved the game so much that actually impacted the game differently than any other player. And I think I just want to be remembered as, you know, Deku Tsholofelo Modise that went through so much but made it. I wouldn't want my story to become one of those things that people that are in difficult circumstances or situations, and then they get imprisoned by their situation. You know, I taught myself how to speak English because of football. Bruh, not gonna go school and say where they teach you English. This skin twill, you know. So I had to teach myself how to do interviews and how to do all this. So the
articulate.
Game, exactly. So the game has taught me so much. So now, actually, I'm getting paid to talk.
Wow.
And I was never a talker. I didn't want to talk. So now I'm getting paid to talk. And it's something that footballers are scared to do. They're scared to talk. They're scared to project themselves because they're scared to be laughed because they might say some word that is wrong and people will make memes of them. Whatever the case might be.
It's not even our fucking. It's not our mother tongue.
Exactly, it's not. But also, it's also showing footballers that you don't allow people to box you as just a footballer just because you're chasing after this round thing. You're stupid. You're actually not. You know, there's brains that comes with that. Actually,
and you're human at the end of the day.
Exactly. So there's a big responsibility that still needs to do.
Yeah, but I'll still swap my life for yours, man. Hey, this guy's a rock star. Zakal.
Yeah, man.
We out here, man. Podcast and chill. Boom.